Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Board of Selectmen. Today is April 3rd, 2017. Maybe we won't have to authorize any more expenditure of funds for snow and ice after this date.
After this date.
After this date. I think. We'll see. Crocuses are blooming. Sort of. All right. You want to read your thing now or you want to wait to the end?
Nope, to the end.
I thought you'd give us some inspiration.
It's not an inspirational quote.
It's not.
Uh-oh.
All right. So I will go immediately to public comment because we were going to be just doing a finance discussion. So public comment. Please.
I think that's a you guys. Okay. That's a tee up for you guys.
Well, we're just here for the financial discussion.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Where do you want to start there? Team, let's.
Yes.
You have the latest numbers?
They do.
They do? Okay. All right, you want to go through each group? Ready to do that?
I think if we go through each group, Mr. Chair, that it's important to bear in mind that we didn't take action last week on the Personnel Committee's recommendation. Another piece in the budget process, the Capital Improvement Committee, again, meets tomorrow night to bring forward to the board the full recommendation. And I think after our meeting last Thursday,
Sure. What personnel recommendation?
They only brought one.
Well,
there's an alternate coming from the library tonight. That's part of the discussion.
David, which one of these is did you recommend?
Was the 41?
The 41,000?
Yeah, it reflects the adjustments with the 2% COLA, all non-union.
So what's your recommendation again?
That's like the total. The recommendation was to put in all the adjustments.
All right, I have just a question on the adjustments. I don't know, when I went through the Franklin County I went through the Franklin County FERCOG wage survey, and I'm just going to look at one position, the highway superintendent. Our highway superintendent was right in the upper median of all those surveyed in Franklin County. So, and I would say. I would say, like, the town, I'm not sure Deerfield just come off the top of the head and they're a neighbor. There's a difference between those positions, superintendent, highway superintendent, Deerfield highway superintendent, in my opinion, in Sunderland. Sunderland has two guys plus a highway superintendent. Deerfield has many more employees, has foremen. Different levels of management. Also, he's got 3, 4, 5 cemeteries that they take care of. They dig. They maintain. So I don't think you can just look at pure salaries to make a recommendation. I think there's and again when I look at the highway superintendent, I didn't bring the numbers with me, but there's some superintendents that make the same, if not less, than our highway superintendent, and they don't get snow and ice or any overtime. Ours gets snow and ice overtime. So I'm just saying I'm going to have a hard time supporting what the personnel committee put forward. I think that you can, I see one of the towns in here is Sheffield. Sheffield is a lot different community than we are. Sheffield is in the western part of the state, next to the Connecticut-New York border. They have a lot of homes in Sheffield that are people that reside in them, only they're from New York, New York City, Westchester County. Those vacation homes, they don't use as much services. So they're not putting kids in the elementary school typically. Very expensive homes. Matter of fact, I know a few people live in Sheffield. I don't necessarily would say that Sheffield and Sunderland are, besides population wise, are have a lot in common. So I think when you look at basing salaries, there has to be a difference. There is a difference. And I'm just going to say I'm not going to support it for a couple of reasons. But one, I think the study is well intentioned. I don't think it hits the mark where we need to go. Okay. My opinion. Okay. So, what do you want to go at, Scott?
Well, I think if we could, Mr. Chair, again, the total piece of the budget, we should circle around the personnel committee's recommendation, because there is two components. The first is cost of living increase, pretty traditional across both negotiated with unions as well as approach the town has taken over the past many years. And then there is a series of adjustments to the means, I think was their intent. That said, those totals add up to $40,000+ of what's essentially a recurring expense moving forward, right? When all said and done. Yeah. Less than 10 total if we go across COLAs, and then again, 30 plus added if we go across with steps. That said, they're concentrated, one, at the highway department, and then secondly, at the library. And the library is here again tonight, and I think they're here to talk about those pieces. That said, I would also remind folks in the budget process that the library, for their advocacy, has been pretty, the library has been both well advocated for thoroughly and professionally, as well as one of the very first of all the departments to kind of move back past, and I hate using 2009 as the benchmark, but 2009 was the first year we made significant cuts across the budget. And in 2014, which was now four full budget cycles ago, the library was at or ahead of 2009. And that's important to bear in mind while the trustees and the staff work just really hard at keeping that organization in top-notch form. It's important to bear in mind that, you know, we're at now the $151,000 a year mark request. And that they've never had a budget of that size, while other departments still simply don't have 2009 levels yet. Regardless of the personnel committees, again, because it's weighted in two areas. Mm-hmm. We got police, I'm sorry, we got highway, and we got several positions in the library.
And that was after going through the positions to see which ones.
Totally.
Right, that's
it.
What we ended up with. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we've had that discussion numerous times about what are the proper comp towns to use. And, mm-hmm. and quite frankly, I think the whole process is in need of a lot of improvement mm-hmm. in general. Because one of the things that I mentioned is I'd like to get this kind of review on an automatic, like a programmatic approach mm-hmm. like we do with the COLAs.
Sure.
But it's not that easy as we've come and discuss.
Sure. I would suggest also that, you know, we have a highway department of three full-time plus seasonal
right.
that works diligently on, you know, 44 square miles of area. And we have a library that is effectively the height, the top of the peak when it comes to hours worked, available services, great programs, and frankly is a blend between library services and rec and school. And so there's a thread there that I believe the town has to support levels of excellence across all its departments, and the library does a particularly good job at that. However, again, I say in 2014, we came back to 2009 levels. Programs have continued to expand. Their budget has continued to expand. And now this year in 2018, we're well above anything that, that the town has ever committed to them for funding. Sorry.
I think the way that these salaries are compared to the other towns, getting the comp towns and everything else, to actually do a comprehensive study, I think you have to take into account, you know, the responsibilities, the actual job task of each person and everything. I believe this came to a head of last year when we had the police chief search committee. We had a number of police chiefs that or candidates that dropped out once they found out what the salary was.
Sure.
It was, what, 7-8 years ago you did a search for the highway superintendent, and I don't believe the pool of candidates was that large, you know, basically based on the salary. I think that the salaries that have been put forth with the percentages, I think they're fair, and I think what you should include them in the budget, but take a look at the actual task and the assignments. And if you have to add job responsibilities to some of the people, you know, you go ahead and do it. If you make it a salary instead of an hourly position, like with the highway superintendent, this is your salary, no matter how many hours you work, because he is kind of management. Yeah. You know, that's something you can do, is a decision you guys make.
Sure.
But I think the recommendations that they came up are doable.
Well, I would.
That's just my feeling. I don't know how our board feels about it. But.
So if I could, Mr. Chair, the police chief search actually lagged behind a great deal behind the town administrator search. And the town administrator over the last two budget cycles has decided to keep her salary at the first year's freeze. And I think you'll understand the pressures in and around that. There's also the intention that is the ability for the town to pay.
Right, I realize
so,
that.
So, right off the bat, the proposal from the personnel committee adds $44,000+ this year, plus you're resetting that expense going forward.
Right.
If the notion of attracting a police chief for the town, which was five full-time department plus as many as 10, currently five part-time, holds us back, then we have to reconsider that piece. I understand that completely. The trap becomes the tension between our ability to raise revenue and then have Sunderland be able to attract the highest possible personnel. You know, we're at a space right now where a department of three at the highway department would be hard pressed in the private sector. I apply your private sector experience to pay someone at the range that's being afforded as a base salary plus overtime going forward. With respect to the police chief, it was very much the same situation. So I struggle with all that. We'll hear tonight a request for a one-time request, right, to fund an event in the future. That may not be recurring, but all of these end up being recurring, and the red number at the bottom right is something that has to be paid for next year. Yeah,
I think those are recurring expenses, yeah. And I think what we all have to realize,
sure,
is we have to support the town budget, and if that requires an override, that requires an override. It's been 94, 95.
10 plus, yeah. 10 since, plus.
Yeah. And back in the early 90s, at the time, the treasurer, Richard Bump, basically did an evaluation of how 2.5 affects the town.
Yeah.
And because our growth doesn't keep up with what the costs are in inflation, basically every 7 years we would need, may I say, an override to correct everything.
Yep. A reset. Yep.
A reset.
Yep.
And if it's been, you know, 95, 2005, it's been 20-something years.
Yep.
You know, it's time. And I think the people and the voters have to realize it's time to reset things. And maybe this is the year we have to reset things.
You were here last meeting, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So,
and those numbers become daunting. You go, well, wait a minute.
Right. Actually, and I mean, we've avoided it. You know, maybe this is the year of reckoning.
Yeah. Great point. I would also go back, and I've said to not just folks in this room, but also folks at the town meeting floor, that if there was, you know, wholesale attrition in departments or the inability to attract people to positions in the town of Sunderland, we would have a global indicator that there's a problem. Mm-hmm. We don't have high turnover in the town of Sunderland. We have people who move from Sunderland. It's important to bear in mind the characterization of the town and the professionals who support the town. Sunderland is in a spot that's not quite the starting point, and it's not quite the retirement point in the municipal arc of their tenure. So we have people who are here for a long time. We have other people who are here because they're here in the knowing that they're going to go somewhere else. And we see that in probably 4, 5, 6, 7 years. You see a turnover in a key position. That's an indicator in the private sector, again, that there's a problem, right? If there's giant vacancies you can't fill, there's a problem. We don't have high turnover in the town of Sunderland.
I realize that, Scott. And part of that reason is because people live here. It's convenient for them to work here. Their family situation makes it a great place to work.
Totally get it.
You know, you put all those things in there. Is just because someone stays in a position a long time, you never give them a pay raise?
That's not even close.
I know that, Tom. I know that.
The last time we didn't give people a pay raise, that's because somebody had a trailer down.
Tom, I realize that.
16 that was saying vote no against the 2.5.
I realize okay? that, but vote that's no. but that's that was many because, years
and,
ago,
and that devastated our schools, Bruce.
I realize that, Tom.
No one cared, Bruce, that we devastated our school for 8 years, right?
Well,
no one cared.
Now's
unless
the time.
You were a parent, and your kid were living through that, and you were pulling in volunteers, and people were donating $60,000 to keep it going. All right. So I will disagree. We have been raised. Matter of fact, if we follow, and this is one thing that I don't quite understand is that if we followed our personnel bylaws or pay salary, we've been over the last few years, we've been giving more than what the increase has been called for. We've rounded up twice. All right. So somebody's gonna say we're balancing the budget on the backs of our employees. I don't agree with that assessment.
Well, let me add a point of clarification too from the personnel committee side. We went through, we did the numbers, and we can, there are some differences with some of the positions. But also, one of the things we had to consider is you have to sort of take a two-step look. We looked at what we wanted to do philosophically, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we wanted to keep our
good
people.
Point, actually.
Because especially I'm in kind of an odd position because I have to wear the personnel committee hat there, but then when I come here, I have to wear the select board hat. But in any way, we sat down and we said, all right, philosophically, we want to kind of target the mean or the group. And put aside for a moment whether some towns are right in that mix or not, because we went back and forth a lot over that part
right.
of it. And honestly, it's a tough thing to chase. But anyway, so you've got this group of peer towns. We wanted to get ourselves targeted in the middle of in the mean for that for the positions, but then we also know that we're going to run up against the reality of the budget. This is the recommendation from the committee, but we also knew that you know what it may not survive in the recommended form, but we needed to have it on the table to look at in light of all of the other budgetary issues that we've got coming up. And you know, one of the things we had in the back of our mind is maybe we have to phase them in. But the problem does become if you say, all right, you're going to phase them in over, you know, say 3 years or something. And you, for a second, you have to put aside individual specific positions and just look at
the group, then you're always kind of going to be playing catch-up. But there's a lot of factors involved in here. And actually, as we went through this, too, I'm really unsatisfied with the information that's available everywhere. And this is one of the reasons why we're looking at, like, maybe next year about, like, hiring the Collins Center or somebody to help us with this. But that's one of the reasons why groups like that get hired, because there is no good database. I mean, you would think with all the information available, this kind of information that gets put into these things really ought to be in, like, a centralized, maybe we'll call it at the COG level database. And then you plug in your updates every year in each town. So it should be a piece of cake in a lot of ways to do this, but it's a grueling nightmare. And then, right, you have the differences in any given position, what this town has as their job description and what that one has as its job description. That's information you have to get put into the database, too. And that's one of the things I'm going to be talking to the COG about, is trying to, like, come up with a better way to do this, because it's, and their stuff is even worse to look through. I mean, their stuff was terrible. It wasn't really that useful in the process. So, I mean, you know, we know what kind of that, you know, we have to ask for something based on the philosophy of what the committee is there for. But we know, you know, that there's budgetary reality, too. So it's a tough process.
I know.
Lauren?
So I'd just like to say, on the library behalf, before we, you know, by the time we come here and present something to the personnel committee, or we're down to the one piece of paper. But we must have looked at 20 or 25 towns when we started our analysis, and then we take out the highs and the lows, and we really consider what, you know, this is just looking at library employees, because in fact, you know, some towns may be comparable for library service and not for police or highway. So we started with a much bigger group and worked down and took people out and put people in and tried not to sway it one way or another, and you still come up with a pretty big discrepancy. I mean, I don't think there's a perfect way to do it, but we, you know, before we even came in with our initial request, which as you can see we kind of lowballed, you know, we did quite a lot of research and tried to really come up with something that's fair. So, you know, I would just like to suggest that we accept the fact that our salaries are out of whack and talk about what we can afford and not whether people are worth the money.
Yeah, with respect to the sentiment of the dialogue, I tend to agree with that. That's why it was important to bear in mind that important for me to comment about the quality of the service that the library provides, you know, and all said and done. Some days it may feel like volunteer work, as I've said, and many people have heard me say it before, any given day, as someone self-employed, I work for a nonprofit too, right? That's any given day. That said, the roles roll up into the total of the budget. Circling back to Bruce's point, if we look at the request under version 2 right here, we're starting our, we're in a position at this point in the budget process at 105,000 and change in the hole, right? We know, we've heard from, this is bigger picture, so forgive me for jumping back on that train car. If we know we're starting, we bring to town meeting something with a structural deficit of $105,000, and we know that we have a $44,000 increase in this year's cycle, we know that's the new baseline for next year. We've heard from the elementary school, and rightly so, that this year's baseline is going to effectively be short for next year. Then we have to be in a position to have a conversation about an override, at least for that $105,000, if not in anticipation. Now, I'd asked last week Sherry to check with the DOR, are we bound by a cap with respect to an override, right? Operational override. And the answer is no, you can put a value of dollars on the override, and that's simply your ability to raise. You don't have to use it, but it's your ability to raise. Pretty straightforward. The voters and the electorate may not understand that mechanism. And that's an important piece as we go forward, Bruce, if there's a real discussion about an override, that just because we ask for a value of dollars moving forward doesn't necessarily mean that it's built into this expense budget. However, it's clearly empirical that your ability to raise oftentimes matches your expenses. And I think there's something that has to be conveyed if we talk about that revenue side. You know, finance committee, personnel, capital, all of us who work on the budget as we see it right now, we kind of the gatekeepers. We got advocates and you got gatekeepers. And we're in the gatekeepers discussion right now at $105,000+ in the red. So I agree with you about not personalizing it. On the contrary, people come to work every day to not get hurt and do good work. Every single day.
Can't personalize it. No.
Right.
I think the discussion is a very important discussion to have. And I would say that you have to look at sustainability. Is what you're trying to do sustainable? And trying to make it sustainable is important. You can decide to try to get an override, and I don't know if it would pass or not. I know if you go to the Thursday's men's club and ask them about an override, you'd probably get laughed right out of the room. I don't know what happened at the women's club on two Thursdays after it, but I'm sure that probably not everybody wouldn't be up jumping up and down and say it's a great idea. But there was some, but in my opinion, you have to look at trying to look at what is sustainable. I know, and I'm going to address library, but the library's on the thing. We always end up doing this. But when you look at the staffing of the library, there's a lot of people that have titles. And I was going through the Franklin County wage survey, and they don't, many towns, I'm not saying all towns, many towns don't have heads of youth services, they have library aid. I knew you were gonna say something.
Yeah, of course.
I knew.
Because a library aid does not have the same responsibilities or job description as my head of youth services. My head of youth services, maybe you mean she is the youth services department. It's not like she's overseeing people, but she is responsible for that entire department and all the services our library provides to youth. It's a completely different position, and I understand that a lot of libraries may not have that, but they also don't have the level of service that we have. And people ask us for this service. This isn't, we're not providing it for ourselves. This is something that is a need in our town that we're providing.
And I guess that's my whole conversation about sustainability. Some towns, I thought, if John Zachary was here right now, after Patty had mentioned about our cost per pupil standing versus the rest of the state, well, when you look at those numbers, there's a lot of information that goes into those numbers, and understanding, because we our cost per pupil is more than Hadley, and we get a lot of school choice from Montague and Greenfield, where we have in the past. And they're like sometimes $2,000-$3,000 more than us. So I guess we should all be sending our kids to Greenfield and Montague because they pay more than we do. But we don't do that because of the teachers that we have and the administration that we have at Frontier and at Sunderland Elementary. And they know what they're getting for services or financial support. And they do what they have to do to make that happen. I guess when I looked at the numbers, I was actually pretty surprised at what happens in a lot of other communities and what makes up those numbers. It's amazing what goes into making up those numbers. But I was I have an increased admiration on how the Sunderland Elementary School and Frontier use their money to produce, because they don't have the highest numbers per pupil cost. They simply don't. So I guess what I'm trying to say is you don't have to have the most expensive program to be a good program. So I guess having the services is a fantastic thing. There's kids, you read, always read about things in the newspaper, and there's always kids from a lot of other towns that are coming to the Sunderland Library to participate in those programs, and that's a great thing. But you do have to look at, is it sustainable?
I think that implies, Tom, that we're spending more than other towns in total, like per, however you want to look at it, per patron. I don't think we've ever really looked at it that way, but my guess is that we are probably on the low end. So, you know, if you want to...
Yeah, I mean, our hours are the same regardless of what programs we're having, and we need to have two people staffing the building at all times. There's very few times where there's three people working in that building. We're very thrifty with how we allocate those hours, and we add these programs on top of our regular duties. So this isn't like I'm adding a whole day of work for someone so they can offer this great program that's serving people from Montague. This is something that they are doing in addition to their other duties. You're not paying anything extra for that. This is just providing a higher level of service.
I mean, if you look at the hourly rates, we're not talking about paying people big enough, you know. These are not fancy salaries that we're talking about. We're talking about paying people $15 or $16 an hour and maybe taking it up from there. So I don't think that we're talking, we are not talking big numbers in terms of what people, we are not tossing away money on personnel.
Well, there's one salary is going to be increased from, it's a $9,100 increase. That's a pretty large increase.
That's the personnel committee recommendation. Then, I mean, you look at the recommendation that we put in originally, and then we have proposed a midpoint kind of recommendation that balances some other things that are considerations for us. So the reality is that that would get you to the midpoint, but that isn't where we started. That would be great. We'd be very happy for that. I think we figured, based on last week's conversation, that probably wasn't likely. And we understand that there may not be money in the budget to do it this year. But again, I really would suggest that we don't talk about that. This is not a conversation about the kind of job people are doing or whether they're working.
No one should do.
Absolutely right.
But that's how it's portrayed. We look, you know, for us right now, we're looking at numbers, and it's the toughest part about the budgets, because you have to divest yourself of the personal aspect of the budget. But it was up to me. I do have a problem increasing some. The $9,100. That's on the personnel committee. They got two increases like that. And I don't know how that happens.
You know, looking at the overall budget, you look at our total benefits package. That's $91,000. We have absolutely no control over that.
I've looked at this budget for 18 years, Bruce.
I know.
Harder than you ever have looked at this budget.
Tom, let me just finish, okay?
So you're telling me something I already
know. No, but this is what I'm really... these are things that we have to pay no matter what. You know, we have no control over it. And when you look at the charter school problem, you know, that comes out of the town budget. How many kids do we have going to charter school, both Frontier and the elementary school? And you multiply that times the average of $18,000. You know, we have no control over that. And that's why I'm saying that in order to fund this, the other things, you know, we're picking on things that we can control.
Sure,
And that's not the root cause of why we might need an override or the budget is, you know, in the red.
Well, Bruce, when we had the last...
But I mean, and that's how I think you have to sell it, Tom. I mean, we have to look forward, Tom. We don't have to look back.
Oh, yes, we do have to look back, because if you don't look back, you're bound to repeat the same mistakes over and over again. And I can tell you, when we looked at that override before, there was a number of us that says, you know, if you're not going to pass this budget, we're going to lose kids at school choice. Oh, that you're just hypothesizing that. You don't know that.
Scare tactic.
You don't know that.
Scare tactic.
You know,
heard that.
If we don't vote the override, we're going to lose trash. Oh, well, I want to pay for trash because I don't think I can pay trash cheaper. I can tell you, quite a few people come back to us about the town doing trash because guess what? The cost of trash has been going up. And all of a sudden, it's because now the trash companies know you don't have an option, so they feel comfortable, they know who's out there, so you're being trained. Those are things that we said. No one, a majority didn't listen or believe. They wanted to pay for their own trash. And the thought about kids going to school choice and or charter schools was foreign to them because why would they leave Sunderland? Why would they? Well, I can tell you, because Sunderland didn't have Spanish and Sunderland didn't have strings and Sunderland didn't have instruments and Sunderland didn't have some of the other extra programs that make Sunderland Elementary what it is and want people to stay there. Now, so I... As that's my thought. So you have to look back. And sometimes you have to look at what you can afford and you can't afford. That's not a hard thing. I mean, it is a hard thing, but sometimes it's good to reflect back on what you can afford and not afford. I think, and Scott has said it many times. That when you look at a budget, you're able to make choices, and you find out when you look at the budget. If you look at a lot of our expenses aren't going up because of personnel issues, right? They're going up because software. We have to have software for computers, and they use now instead of $50 or $100 or $300 for software registration or fees. Now they charge $1,500 to $2,000. Every piece of software that the town owns, and it doesn't. And our software now doesn't last. Maybe it lasts 5 years, 7 years. Look at our accounting software, right? And we have to buy new software. So those are just things that we have to do to run the town every day.
So just again, if I could, Mr. Chair, orders of magnitude, right? So if prior to the on the original budget submittal, prior to last week, we have a structural growth of $290,000. I'm above, from the Finance Committee's perspective, I'm above wastewater and debt. It's really important to bear in mind. Wastewater and debt kind of operate outside of the operating budget, are we appropriate for it? So the total operating budget increase as presented prior to V2, I wrote down version 2, is 293, and again we have a pretty solid working history. And Bruce, this may well reinforce your point of about $130,000 to $150,000 between 2.5 and growth, right? So if we apply on that left hand side of the ledger, the 293 or in version 2, the one that we got tonight, the 330, I'm sorry, the 303, we didn't make enough money this year as a town, or last year combined, to pay for this 1 year's increase. And anyway, I know we have to have, I circle back each time to the operating revenue matching the operating expense. That said, that $105,000 hole that we have right now, because we have a combination of accounting and some unspecified accounts being closed, we could actually afford this budget this year. But with no growth next year, we know we start at that 105 all over again. Again, it's just Finance Committee 101.
if we build in a structural increase that is a recurring, whether it's wages or new debt or whatever, that continues out forward until either it's gone or it continues on the same trajectory. So the question becomes, in the case of expenses versus revenues, is it the prerogative of finance committee, right, to go and search actively after an increase in the revenues? See, in the meetings, it seems like it's kind of strategic, right? We're going to take over this nation. We're going to do this. We're going to manipulate the library budget so we can deal with the highway budget, so we can deal with the police budget, so we can attract more people in the future. And the reality becomes, well, what do you end up doing in a couple of years? Can we actually continue to afford to pay for it? Principally speaking, and principally speaking, I think that we fall in that spot where we're not a large community, and we're not really a small community. If you talk to folks who are department heads, we have kind of mid and large community size challenges: infrastructure, circulation, attendance, programs, aspirations, police issues. But we're a pretty small community when it comes to the revenue side. We have a lot of land that's in APR. We have a lot of land that's tied up with the state. We have a lot of lousy pilot formula. And we have largely a growing burden on an aging population, or which I think is a bit disingenuous as well, or non-resident householders who do a fair amount of renting. And that's okay. That's the composition. So how do we go about getting that vote turned out to recognize to the public that we may well need a reset on the revenues? And that's a harder sell on this side, because there's a large sense of defeat that comes up when those ballot measures run across and they go, nah, figure it out. And now we're trying to figure it out.
It's really the same position we were in back in 2009.
Well, that was actually, if I could, David, from an 2009 perspective, that the optics of 2009, we got absolutely just drilled with the national as well as the state economy falling off the the ranks.
It was a combination,
And we did just drilled by it. I remember sitting in this room and people talking about $790,000. You're out of your mind. Well, guess what the real number was? $790,000.
But the public was feeling the brunt of that too.
I totally get that, and they're full of sweetness and light right now.
Investments, no matter what.
Yeah.
But I think times have improved since then.
Yeah, I understand.
And I think the atmosphere is better.
I agree.
And for an override.
And since 2009, we've actually managed to have buy-in from the public, and I think rightly so, on the capital side, which is really, really important. A lot of people who haven't spent time in these sheets don't recognize the impact that capital override has afforded breathing room on the operating budget.
Yes.
Really, really important. So maybe a small reset right now is of true value. And I'd say that, you know, being a service star guy. Anyway.
Well, I think that what happens in a town particularly like ours that has not had a successful override for so long is that people begin to feel that the goal is to never have an override, that you're a failure if you didn't balance on income. And I think that the purpose of 2.5 was not to never override it, to give people the opportunity to determine for the voters to say, yes, this is a time when we need to do it. Like, the budget is, I don't see a lot of waste here. We do need a little more money. We're going to have to raise our taxes. So I think, you know, we have to get out of the mindset of it being that we've done something wrong.
Good point.
We have to. That said, I understand how hard it is to get an override to pass. Do you have anything coming off the tax rate?
Not on the debt schedule. Not currently.
That was the same argument I made with the last override, and I was just about to say the same thing. Is 2.5 isn't there to limit our cost increases to only 2.5%. I mean, how many people here has had a household where your costs have never gone up more than 2.5% over the year? Raise your hand. Anybody? No. And that's the same argument I made, and I was in support of the override before I was sitting in this seat.
And it, that aspect of it doesn't change. And that really comes down to, and we all go through all of this process. We go through the town meeting, and then we see the drastically different result of the polls. And this all comes down to whether the town is going to support that as a whole. That's really where it lies. As much as we spend all of this time doing all this work, you know, like Scott was saying, there's frustration in that, because we look at what's happening down the road, and you could pull the personnel stuff out of here, and we're still going to be in the hole next year, and because of school stuff. The school stuff doesn't even address capital. That's just operating costs, because on the school side, we don't have like a process like we have for the capital where we can save that. So that isn't even included in this.
So could I ask David, of all of the, and I want to circle back off of the big global the tensions associated with revenues and expenses. I want to circle back, if I could, to the personnel committee's recommendation. The philosophy was the goal was to try to position existing town roles in the means.
Yes.
There's two categories here. There's one position, the highway superintendent, and there's 2, 4, 6, 7, all associated with the library. Are you saying that every other position in the town is in the means inside that area? It seems awfully weighted, not to pick on you guys.
Yeah. We went through everything pretty much, right?
All non-union.
Yeah. Right? I mean, I look at one job at the highway department of all of the staff in the town, and then 7 at the library. That's a hard sell.
We did look at it, and then
all of them.
Yeah, and then
all non-union.
Clerk. I understand all non-union.
Yeah, and we knew
accounting, because we have services. You could actually have the cog calling up and saying, "Can we just add a few more hours?" Because, or you know, there's a lot of pressure that's associated with either work demand or, in this case here, job classifications.
And we knew like certain positions, like contractor ones, that we would have to address those at contractor the whole time.
Okay, thanks.
There were a couple of positions that we had trouble finding comp data.
Yep.
Treasurer collector is one. In some towns, there's two people.
It's elected, it's split, it's, yeah, unique duties.
Town, it's treasurer and collector, one position. So, there were some challenges to getting data.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
The only thing, Lauren, what you said earlier about the 2.5 override. From my position, I sat here and watched the devastation of our schools. I don't want to do that again. And you know what? And I can tell you how it went. It says, the frontier budget wasn't. We weren't able to touch the frontier budget, so we came down. So although the elementary budget was approximately 30% of their total budget, said, "Well, you guys, sorry, you're gonna have to suck up 50% of that $790,000, and the town is gonna have to suck up the other." No one asked the school. Okay, and I didn't, and we just started, and they cut, and we cut. And the only thing I'm saying right now is, like, people have to understand where they're going. And somebody, you know, you may want to challenge every 7 years, and I guess that Richard Bump's calculation 20 years ago was flawed, because we have made it for 20 plus years without an override. Okay? So I guess the calculation was flawed. But If we want to continue to careen towards the override, and I can say this time, I'm not going to look at the school and say you're cutting 50% again. I saw what had happened. They're a large portion of our budget outside of regional assessment, but I couldn't say that to them. So where are you going to go? We're going to start losing positions in town, this office. Okay, we've never gone back to 5 days. We're still at 3.5, 4 days. And the library will be part of it. The police department will be part of it. Fire department will be part of it. I can't go back to school again. It does not make economic sense. And more importantly, it doesn't make sense for our kids to put them through that again. To lose an entire, to lose another 6 or 7 years.
But we're in the same, I mean, similarly to where we were in 08, 09.
Right.
We just don't, there's just not enough money, there, you can't cut up, it's too much money to cut.
Right.
I mean, maybe you'll make it through this year, but you'll be in the same, you know.
We already know we're going to be in
the same. That's the reality.
We know we're going to be there, we know we're going to go next year. We know where we're going to be. You don't have to be a genius. I mean, it is very simple math, and Scott put it right. I mean, we know how much we can increase. We have. It's funny because I hear someone tell us we're flush with money. Well, I guess you could say we're flush with money, but you could also look at it and say it allows us a little, it buys us a little time to try to. Dampen what's going to happen in a couple of years, but we might as well just spend it all because we have.
Actually, Mr. Chair, if I could, with respect to the comments about being flush with money, there is a reason there's $700,000 in free cash this year, and that comes from 2 years of accounting where the capital stabilization override was accounted to an unencumbered funds that added $200,000+. It's very, very clear. It's also really, really clear from the accountant that when that $200,000 over 2 years moved that $300,000+ in to this year's free cash, and last year because of auditors' suggestions, we closed prior year's carryover from as far back as 2007, that the vast majority of what is usually our $250,000 to $320,000 estimate of free cash is one time. That's not going to happen again next year. We've been very clear about that meeting with the accountant. You expect back to being program. So this year, although it feels like we're flush, we're clearly at our levy limit, and what's proposed in front of us is a $105,000 deficit moving forward. So I don't know what flush means, where that definition comes from, but I would suggest that the vast majority of the 700 and change that's in free cash, again, the Finance Committee knows this. They've done the free cash analysis. They know that's one time. And that we can expect 300-ish maybe next year. Again, that analysis is clear from the accountant and from the DOR. So I don't know what flush means. Every year it seems like we're working inside the 2.5 cap.
Okay, so I guess so.
Can you feel the love?
I was just gonna.
Yes, Doug.
Yeah.
I mean, you kind of more or less said it, but just, and we talked about it last 2 weeks, but just to say it again about the with the school situation and the budget in the school. You know, part of what we know is we're spending more this year in school choice money that we're taking in.
Thanks, Natalie.
To the tune of close to 100, in the ballpark of $100,000.
Yep.
And we've been doing that, and so we're no longer doing, you know, spending it a year in arrears. We're going to be cutting it down, you know, closer than, you know, we probably should comfortably do, and so we can't do that again another year. It won't work. Next year we would go into a deficit, which we can't do. So, I mean, with the state. So, so that's like right there. That's $100,000 or more. That.
And again, that's revenue coming in. You know, you've got a built-in expense against.
Yeah.
I think we're all in the. I think we're in the same boat.
Yep.
Rowing the same way. The question is, how do we fix it?
Sort of, yep.
Okay. So we have been discussing the personnel committee's recommendation.
Right.
Do I hear a motion to put the personnel committee's recommendation into the budget as it stands?
I'll make that motion to include in the budget as it stands for discussion.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Discussion.
I appreciate the fact that the cost of living is built inside of that. I think that's consistent with the formula that was developed a number of years ago, and that's very, very important. I struggle a little bit with some of the shifts in the classifications of jobs to get to the means. I also struggle with the fact that they seem to be weighted in one department, effectively one department, seven positions. That said, I understand that the library it exceeds their original request, which I get formula, and actually I kind of like policy and procedure. I really, really do.
There was a lot of back and forth about
that,
right? Because then we decided to stick to a formulaic.
Right.
And that's why it ended up that way.
And I value that. I really do, David, because that oftentimes eliminates some of the kind of the horse trading give and take that goes on.
That said,
the library themselves have also, inside of their request, were reached out to today, and they're coming with maybe some measure of moderation we could plug in a future iteration of our budget, if I'm understanding it correctly. So I think it would be helpful as we talk about the budget. We may not have the actual number when we leave here tonight, right? The actual number for the operating budget, but we may have some middle ground that's associated with library expense, and it will help us with the framework of the discussion about revenues. Where do we go? What's the scale if we choose to go that way? That discussion's coming up next, so stay tuned.
And like we said, we knew, you know, we came across with a recommendation, but we knew, you know, we may not be able to do it. So.
Understood.
Okay. Any more discussion?
No more discussion. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
So we have a motion on the table to include.
Include as presented.
As presented. By the personnel committee. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed, say nay.
Nay.
Nay. So I hear 3-0. So we'll start all for now. Well, but we get someplace.
I think it's important to bear in mind, there is an increase that's being presented by the departments in their original format.
All right. Make your presentation now, or you want to talk about it next week? Probably next week, huh? Well, you're going to give the
share. It's in your books.
Yeah. I think it's important to bear in mind that we need to have numbers plugged in so that we can go forward with a budget no later than next week. We have to be able to vote the budget next week.
Yeah.
Okay.
Next week. Perfect. Did you want to say anything else? Go ahead.
So you have some options of number that we've presented for us, but you're also going to need to plug in the other numbers, right? That's what you're talking about.
Yeah, we have the original requests from departments currently.
So I'll try to we as a board have always valued the input of our boards and committees. So we always agree, but we always so. If you came to us and you told us that the numbers that you first submitted, you're going to stand 100% behind those, no matter what. And basically, what we would tell you is that we would put our numbers in there, but we would let you know how you could change the budget on town meeting floor. We've always done that, right? We've done that with the school. We've always done that.
We have
so next week we'll put. We'll discuss your new numbers. We have to discuss the highway superintendent's numbers, and we will put in a number. So I haven't looked at your numbers yet. So I will do that tonight.
May I say a word about those numbers?
Yeah.
So our goal with providing you an alternative besides our original request is the idea that it's a happy medium between what the personnel committee recommends, which is the average salary for these positions based on what we thought were comparable libraries and comparable towns. And we do think that it is a feasible step in the right direction. It doesn't get us exactly where we need to be, but it is a good step. And that way, we're not asking for these massive increases every single year. So what we originally put forward was a very modest request because we understand that it is a financial strain on the town. But the fact is these modest requests we're going to be making them for the next 30 years if in order to get where we want to go. So
that was one of the points I brought up.
So we don't want to be here for the next 30 years. You don't want to see us for the next 30 years making the same argument. So this alternative is it's going to make a good jump. It's not going to get us exactly where we need to be, but we understand there's no way we can make it that far in 1 year.
Tom, do you want a copy of it?
Yeah, thank you.
You have it. You're looking at the library trustees' alternative is one you're putting forward now.
Yes.
Your agenda book.
So that's a happy in between this one and this one.
So this is what the personnel committee recommended.
Yep.
This is what we originally requested.
Yep. Okay. And then this is what
put it in their agenda.
What we would like.
Okay.
He's just good.
And I think, you know, we went further, that we thought carefully about those numbers, and that also, you know, we have people who've been here for different lengths of time with different responsibilities. We tried to, if we were going to be an in-between request, we tried to take that into account so that it makes sure more confirmed.
So it's a $10,000 savings over what the personnel committee's request was and $5,000 more than your original request. Okay.
What was the thinking behind the drop between the original to the alternate in circulation is the same? Because it looks like that dropped completely down to personnel recommendation.
Sorry, should have brought more copies. So circulation assistant.
Yeah, so you had 4% I believe, and that dropped down to the personnel.
So essentially our goal is really to bring it up to the local average, and our original request, I had just done a fair percentage across the board for all employees, the 4%. So it turns out that the local average is much lower than the 4%. So in terms of keeping it even, you know, fair and based on that procedure, looking into what the personnel committee said, that employee with that 1.4% increase will be at the average, which is our goal.
Okay. So what was the alternate is based on the comparison between the towns. What was the original based on?
It was based on comparisons between what I thought were comparable libraries.
Okay.
Because I didn't have what the comparisons were going to be.
Okay.
Yeah.
So good, Mr. Chair. Just noodling over the two tables, I see there's step changes, of course, in five of the six categories, and then one not change with respect to the director. No offense. Is that associated with contract talks, or is that just a function of the table?
Say that again. Why that's above the personnel committee? Is that what you're asking? Why it's above the personnel committee recommendation?
For the library director.
Correct. That one didn't move a heck of a lot across the compromise.
Right. The library director did not make that salary projection herself. Mm-hmm. The board did that a couple months ago. We voted on that, that we would like to give her a certain amount. That is because of the job that she does and because we want to keep her.
Understood. It just jumps off the page. That's why I ask. And then again, I appreciate all the work that goes into keeping a world-class facility running and programs.
Okay. All right. So so you're looking at putting in the BO, the bulk original request?
Well, we like the middle one.
You'd like the
alternate, right? Right. So what I'm hearing, Mr. Chair, is it sounds like there's an alternate we have to plug in somewhere between the 14 and change, I'm sorry, 23 and change, and 21,566, which is headed to the library. It looks like it's almost a $11,000 reduction. We have to just plug the exact number in.
$10,000.
Right.
We'll talk about that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Actually, I like the fact the Board of Library Trustees comes up as the bolt. I think that's great.
The whole town together.
That's right.
I will say one thing about this process, having done it a few times too, is I like to get this to a year where we're all agreeing on what our comps are,
right,
and our things, because that actually is one of the most frustrating things about this whole process, because we spend a lot more time arguing about that part of it
sure
than the numbers.
Yeah, I was going to say I would really appreciate it after town meeting when we all have a lot more free time.
Are we going to have coffee someday?
Please do, please. So, like, we could sit down with the finance committee, the personnel committee, the selectmen, and any departments and come up with what our comparables are. Because it would save everyone a lot of time in the long run, and it would help us plan ahead better.
Because then we're all in agreement over that, and then we move forward from that basis.
Yeah.
And that's a frustrating thing. And I understand, I think in some ways when you look at the library versus the comp towns for the town, it is a little difficult because the fact is that we end up, our library supports not just us. It is what it is. So, I mean, I get, you know, and those are all the things we need to talk about.
Or maybe that you have to look at more, you know, I think it's harder to find 5 to 7 towns that are exactly like yours than it is to maybe find 10 or 15 towns that have a range, that maybe they're more like the library but less like the highway department, and some are more like the highway department but less like the library, and so then somehow you get to an average that everyone can feel, you know, represents us as a whole.
Sure.
And so, then you can't go back and say, but, you know, Hadley has so many more people than we do, you know, because...
Yep.
How were they chosen initially?
It's a great
question.
The comp towns.
I looked at some and I was like, wow.
So we need to make Frankentown, right? Based on the departments. There's like pieces all stitched together to make town. I like it.
Well, like we saw, there are some positions where there just aren't
any
comparables. So,
okay.
Yeah. It's fun. Touch in May to arrange that. I'm really looking forward to it.
Well, you almost need a little separate workshop with all of us together. And it's something that really, you know, has needed to be done, but we've just been busy with other stuff. So,
okay.
I would just like to offer one suggestion, is that you hire people at an appropriate wage. And I would, it looks like, so it's easy to start a program if you're not paying the appropriate wage. Pay the appropriate wage, see the true impact on the budget,
right.
And then you can move forward.
So we hired these people 15 years ago.
Some.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, totally.
Well, except for Megan.
Yeah. Understood.
So we may have hired them at an appropriate wage, but we haven't been able to keep them going up as costs have gone up. And
great point.
We've had a head of adult services and head of youth services for 15 years?
Yeah, the former head of adult services was had been here for 30 years.
Laura.
I mean, maybe her title had changed, but as long as I've been here, she was head of adult services.
You just replaced that position, right?
Erin took over her hours.
We combined senior librarian.
And
she had 3 hours, and now Erin
It was 6 hours.
Yeah.
Erin was at 10 hours. Now Erin is head of adult services at 16 hours a week. So he's doing both jobs.
Well, and like I said, you have to. It's hard to see one department that's so underpaid.
It's hard to look at the percentages when you have people who are basically underpaid and work very few hours. And so if you go up 50 cents an hour, you have, it could be a 15% increase in someone's salary or whatever it is. And when you look at the hourly wage, you say, this is not a lot. You know, we are not talking about, we are talking about people who are making under or just about what the minimum wage is going to be when minimum wage is adjusted.
And they work, one works 25 hours a week, one works 15 hours a week. You know, that's also part of it. They're not in the total compensation package. They don't get anything except for the 25 hour a week, the head of youth services.
Not part-time. Or part-time, not part-time.
Okay.
Perfect. Thanks so much for the middle ground.
All right.
Thank you.
Going through the budget, you want to go through the budget steps now?
Yes. I think we should go by category, if I could, Mr. Chair.
Selectman's budget, you want to talk about anything in there?
The only thing I would suggest in the selectmen's budget that stands out is we have a contractual obligation to the town administrator that's been deferred by 1 year. Last year, the town administrator did not take her salary step, as was in her contract, and I give her credit for that. This is year three, believe it or not, we're beginning the execution of year three of her contract, and took no raise in year two.
Okay.
Beyond that, $472.
Okay, accountant.
Accountant is really, really straightforward. It has primarily to do with the additional hours as well as from prior year, and then an adjustment for the COG this year. And that's the COG in the rate. I would say this, we've seen evidence in the closing of the books on a 35 to 45 day basis. Yeah. The accountant and treasurer for the first time in quite some time are nearly in sync, which is really, really important. Again, from the finance committee's perspective, really important to have those books closed in the 35 to 45 degree 5 day window. We submitted our Schedule A just about on time.
Oh, you mean it's not good to get a letter? And
we don't want a letter from the DOR anymore.
April, say, exactly. where's
your submittal? Exactly. So this year, I think that money spent, that $1,800 has been.
Finance committee, if you see anything more, stop the show, would you please? Yeah. Assessors?
I think they're all about software.
Yeah, that's the big data jump. That's all that software.
Yeah, that's
all that software.
That's contracted services.
Thank you, software.
The one thing that the assessors are doing this year is they're actually going out for bidding this year.
And that's the bid result, Tom?
Yeah. So they actually went out and and looked at someone instead of just.
Wasn't that the thing that they said that there was only like two responses to the bid, though? So
yeah.
Back to that trap. Treasurer collectors.
Treasurer.
Again, primarily to do with the salary based on these percentages in here for the spreadsheet that's in front of us, Sherry, are all based on the 2%.
2%.
Okay.
Town clerk.
Same animal, although I think we're election year coming up.
Okay, election, we're down this year.
Right, that's specific arrangement, exactly.
Total committees and boards.
It's down 17.
Looks like we fired somebody. Oh, telecom, moved it to FCAT.
Yep. Moving to FCAT, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So again, it's important to bear in mind, we had for a long time the Sunderland Telecommunications Committee was actually on the rate, although paid for out of, I'm sorry, it was in the budget, although paid for out of the Comcast revenue. And in this case here, those responsibilities have been taken over by FCAT. That'll show up in our FCAT expense, but it also will show up with the Comcast revenues, license revenues going to FCAT. As we talk about the revenue sheet here, you'll see FCAT use, or Comcast PEG access is actually used.
Town buildings.
Sure, we're going to talk a little bit, if you could, about how we're strategizing energy.
Yeah, to roll all of the Schedule Z accounts that are going to receive benefits from the solar project into one account. A new account to be called Municipal Buildings Energy Solar.
Right.
We will have payments to Kearsarge.
Right. Okay. So part of the shift, and it's going to be a bit of a culture shift for both departments as well as the elementary school, as the district and the superintendent knows, we generate now electricity that's going to be about 90%+ of the consumption of the elementary school, so that electricity line's got to get migrated over so we can now pay for it. And we're working with our two offices are working together on how to figure that out. We're not taking money out of your budget. We're just letting you know it's got to be allocated a certain way. And that's really, really important to bear in mind. We've had some green community projects that have gone on the debt schedule until they're paid down, and then the energy reduction pays for that. Not too far from that kind of a model. Okay?
So I haven't backed those out of the expense accounts yet, but it looks like it'll be in total, that line will be 120, but it'll be in and out.
Right. And again, that's based on the generation hours, 384 kWh annually, and then scheduled out across the departments, including the library, as a matter of fact. So, and again, it's a culture change.
So, we need to vote the budget again, then our budget.
Reduce it by that amount.
Taking that out, because we're meeting this Thursday.
Bills will come here and they'll be paid from out of this account.
Right.
As long as there's nothing else we need to account for potentially, you know, that we just don't even think about that anymore in the budget.
Yep. On the trustee side, the first year, I think it's important to bear in mind, Doug, as well as superintendent, that the first year we need to be able to be reactive in the event usage shifts. Generation is going to be dynamic because of the nature of it, mm-hmm. but usage also is dynamic.
Yeah, sure.
So we'll look at this year, uh-huh. and again, we're looking at that percentile, that percentage of consumption and generation. We know we're scheduling it out, and it's important to bear in mind, it's also based on a performance guarantee from the people who built this and released the system from.
But my understanding is it's just moving out of our budget, so we don't have to think about
it. It goes here.
Yeah. You need to think, be thinking about that. But we don't.
Right.
Is that right?
I'm just
to clarify.
Right.
Another piece of that is Eversource has filed for a rate hike, too. And
correct.
We don't know how all of that's going to pan out. So.
Superintendent?
So in the event that what you garner from the program doesn't cover what is being used at the school, what will be the alternative?
We actually have, it's a great question. We actually have an energy contingency line built in the budget. And so if there is a transfer that's required, it won't be on the school side. It'll be all on our side.
On our side.
That's great.
Great. We're assuming all the responsibility and hopefully about that much benefit.
What, 7.5%?
About 7.5%, exactly.
7.5%.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, whatever, that's great. I mean, it's the town project, it makes sense. And as long as... just the clarity that then we don't need to worry about it budgetarily in any way.
Don't worry, Doug. We won't let you forget that we're paying for it.
But it's a really fair question. This is the year of transition.
Yeah.
And that full budget cycle is really important
right.
base data point to understand across all of the buildings that we're scheduling that consumption of electricity out to.
Right.
So it's you guys, library, this building, no wastewater, highway. We got to keep an eye on all of it. Street lights as well.
Questions? Okay. Total government?
$11,000, and you saw the components that are driving part of that. And part of it is, again, energy. Part of it, again, is salary. Part of it, again, is, you know, 200 here, 400 there, all the way through.
2.1. I'm sorry. Police. Questions on police?
There is one piece of expense in the police that we are in the process of negotiating, and this does not carry any value in that. So we're in the 11th hour of the contract negotiations. And we're at the money discussion right now. So there is opportunity for wages and some expenses to go up. And I would suggest that we plug in a holding number for our next meeting.
Okay, can you discuss that with Sherry, please?
I will.
You don't want to give away our negotiating position.
We're meeting Thursday. We're working Thursday morning, 7:30. And we have to bring coffee because we missed last week's meeting.
Fire department?
They want a big truck.
Yeah.
Heard that.
Yeah, 2 point inspectors.
Same thing. They're down. They don't want a big truck.
I was going to say they're looking for
other protection.
Under other protection, if I could, Mr. Chair, this radio system, we've gotten confirmation from our police and fire chief as well as late as today about a study about regional communications again. And Montague versus Greenfield versus it seems to be a work in progress.
I don't know why we're doing that again.
I know. It seems like it was three, 4 years ago we did this.
We did. And I was the Franklin County Selectmen's Association's rep on that.
Yep.
And basically Greenfield and Montague didn't want to do it because they wanted they use their dispatchers as kind of the receptionists at their department. Mm-hmm. So they want somebody to answer the door.
Right.
Plus when they looked at the, I don't, I don't think. My guess is the sheriff must be wanting to do this.
It's not a half bad idea. It's not a half bad notion.
Well, but then it's going to cost us money.
Absolutely. So again, that regional dispatch right now is straight out of
zero.
Barracks 2. It's cost us nothing.
But you're not, they're not going to have, I mean, they can't do regional dispatch from the state police barracks where it is now. Can't affect their equipment because
right.
they don't have enough room.
Right, right. Hmm. So those correspondence came in again from the police and fire chiefs today.
I think Sunderland's going to end up paying like $80,000 a year for dispatch from nothing. Okay.
I have a question on
that to save
shoot outs.
The streetlights, are we getting more streetlights or are the current ones just costing more?
Current ones are costing more. There's a rate hike pending.
It's important also to bear in mind, Alex, that we're working on a program about, we're exploring a program about ownership and transfer to LED. And that structure could include another community for service and a single out of Green Communities money purchase and installation. And that's something that the utility for the very first time is actually okay with other entities using their infrastructure, primarily the poles. So that language is coming around. We may actually see some drop in usage in the upcoming years. But we've got to get through these programs, see if this program makes sense for the town first.
And the Green Communities is supportive in a move to LED?
Yep, absolutely. And it's quirky in that we have to form or to cooperate with a municipal, a muni electric light company. We have to either make one by statute or by town meeting or work with another one. And there are a handful of them around us. So we're working right now. That application is in place. We'll see how it plays out. I'd like to see that number go to like near zero, but
yeah.
It's going to take some time.
Okay. Highway department?
Yeah, we talked about the superintendent.
Yeah. We're going to put another number in there.
Yeah.
Do you want to talk about that right now, Phil?
Well, I struggle a little bit with the superintendent, the recommendation of the personnel committee, and again, it's not that we're not picking on the library exclusively. I think that the struggle with our working superintendent is overtime wages, snow and ice, and what constitutes salaried manager versus a working superintendent who should be compensated for hours worked. And if you're going to go straight the salary line, straight down the salary path, then subsequent compensation, whether it be hours or whatever, is a bit of a sticky wicket. It's also important to bear in mind that we have a job description and an appointment for the highway superintendent is currently not a contract. And that's also something that the personnel committee may want to explore. So this number, I suspect, is going to be reduced or backed out entirely, and we'll go with a COLA until those discussions come forward. That would certainly be a position I'd advocate for.
So right now, you're recommending COLA? Is that what you're talking
I'm about? Recommending COLA. We actually took a vote earlier to not accept the personnel committee's
right.
recommendation.
David, talk.
Yeah, it's fine. We have to revisit the numbers.
And again, I struggle a little bit, and we've heard this with the national narrative about the term optics. I struggle with the notion of going forward with the need for an override for a sustainable revenue stream and give someone a $9,000 raise because it fits in a nice bracket. That there's tension there between those two things.
Well, when I looked at
$10,000 raise, sorry.
Huh?
$10,000 raise.
Well, right. I would just say when.
If you turn it this way, it's a big scientific calculator.
Yeah, I know. I don't need all my legals. I would just have pluses and minuses.
Right, right. Okay.
I would look at a $1 increase for that
right.
an hourly increase.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be my recommendation. Just when I and don't know how that looks to the, but when I was looking at Franklin County wage survey, that would look like an appropriate number to me.
Across all the other towns in Franklin County, yeah. Yep.
That would, so can you
dollar per hour with COLA or just all right,
we don't have COLA and raises, okay? We have one.
For the other, okay.
One. So how do COLA and...
We were just talking about COLA, so I wasn't sure if you wanted to do both.
I would recommend you.
Okay.
Scott was recommending COLA. Okay. I was recommending $1. David was thinking about it.
Yeah.
All right, he can let you know what he thinks. All right, Highway Department, Health and Sanitation, you want to bring back the $200,000 for the trash?
It depends if we're going to pay for a parade, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Library?
I think we have to plug in the library's recommendation based on tonight and see how that plays out entirely.
What number the bolt?
10,561.
Exactly. Right? I like the bolt. Just the bolt.
Bolt original. You guys are recommending bolt.
Alternate. The middle.
Yep. Right. Yeah. Bolt alternate. Yep.
Not bolt request.
Bolt alternate.
Do you want to put the bolt alternate in?
I think we have to plug that number in and understand where it fits in the total spreadsheet.
Right. Sherry, can you put bolt alternate in?
Yep.
I can't wait to see the emblem now in the Sunderland Elementary.
It's going
to
be great.
When they do the springtime flower sales.
Mm-hmm.
All right, schools. I say zero out the superintendent's salary schedule.
How'd that
Checking
sound?
Who's paying attention.
Just echo us. It's like, it looked straight up from
that.
What?
That was just a check on that. Okay. So you don't have any savings you could find for a Doug, like another $55,000 off that $155,000?
I think it is important to bear in mind, again, there will be a shift from, and it'll look artificial, in that the school will have a potential reduction with respect to moving the energy piece up. And it's important to bear in mind as we communicate the totality of the budget moving forward, that's essentially a lateral. It moved from this column and went to that column.
Yeah. There is, yeah. I mean, that's the tricky bit with the numbers too, with some of these numbers for the school particularly, because, you know, like we've talked about, again, numbers like, you know, what do you guys wind up paying for choice or charter out, things like that that aren't in our budget, and that goes up and down, and there's a real impact on the town.
But those are in our budget, though.
I know.
See, and that's the hardest thing I've ever tried to understand is that charter and outgoing, it's in our budget, and school choice goes
in their budget
to you guys.
Right.
Yeah. Well,
I never figured that
out. Don't
think
too hard on that one, Tom.
I trust me. I've thought about it for since 1999.
I think
it never made sense. So
you know, I think it'd be good. Like, let's you know, going forward, being really clear about you know, the total expense and you know for the school and the total expense of the town, the total sources of this stuff, how all of that is moving. You know, I think we've been trying to do all that, but
we're going to have to make sure that's going to make our per pupil cost go down. Okay.
Maybe one-tenth of 1%, but
I know it.
Yeah.
All right.
36.
Guys, you have any questions on finance meeting, questions on school? Mr. Moderator?
Just a point of information. How much is the balance in your school choice in?
It is, well, I know it's in like by the end of the proposed budget this year that we proposed, it's like 30-something at the end of the year.
And we will...
And then what we're spending this year is like 425-ish, and what we anticipate bringing in is like 349.
So just one.
And at the end of that, it'll be 30-something. So we couldn't do that again. That's my point, is we couldn't do that again. you know, we're dipping into the reserve more and more, getting to that point where we next year, you know, at most we should spend what we anticipate bringing in, or even try to build the reserve back, you know, if that was possible humanly. So like, that's where I was saying that, you know, I can see it being easily 100,000 shift, you know, next year before anything, yeah,
right.
Before any other consideration, you know, just in terms of being responsible and prudent in how we can spend that school choice.
Okay.
When we, if we will re-vote the budget Thursday night, mm-hmm. how would you like us to give you the budget? Just send it to you?
Yeah.
As
suggested, and okay, we'll send it to you here.
Yep, inside that language, if I could, then make sure that it's recognizing only the change in the energy piece, so that again we continue to you know, document what that is. It's not a real reduction. It's simply a shift.
You're not going to give that one to us?
No. We thought we were trying to get away with it.
You've cut every meeting.
Okay, benefits and insurance.
With respect to the actual other two assessments, Mr. Chair, we have Franklin Tech as well as Frontier.
Yep.
And if I could ask the superintendent, I understand the strategy with respect to the Whately building. At some point, there was going to be some cost offing about the operating expenses of that space. Just keep us in the loop with that.
Yes, we're hoping by fall we will have actually
Someone's going to buy it.
Yeah, we're
right?
hoping.
Right.
We're hoping. We have an oil tank to take out and prepare.
It's very simple.
The building committee meets twice every 2 weeks, and so we're working on that.
That's what it was worth.
We hope by
Can
the
we
fall.
Give it back to Whately?
Yeah, let's just give it to Whately for a dollar.
For a dollar.
Right.
No,
$1.
I'll give
give them the dollar. Please take your building.
Ironically, at our last meeting, they did. One of the select board members came and said, "Well, they had told us earlier they don't want it." But then they came back and said, "Well, do you want to look at it for something? We have three properties. Let's look at it and see." But I don't know.
They found oil underneath it.
Yeah. Gonna put a derrick out there.
Nice.
Okay.
TV system. Okay, thank you.
Where are we going now?
Benefits and insurance. Mm-hmm. The driver here, of course, is going to be a combination of workers' comp, added hours, and a shift. And then the last piece was town employees' medical. And we were told by our actuarial that our medical, we have been, frankly, get ready for a significant change in our rates.
Tom, just want to make a note, we have no control over this whatsoever. It's $91,000.
Well, actually, Bruce, glad you raised it. The point is that it's actually estimated. It could come back as elements of that free
absolutely.
Cash for next year.
Absolutely.
But if we run short,
absolutely.
we look like
right.
You know, I used the term knuckleheads a week ago.
Right.
We look like knuckleheads.
Right.
The increase?
Oh, if it's underspent. If it's underestimated, we look like fools. If it's underspent, we just see it as free cash.
Well, be going to the finance committee for
transfers,
reserve transfers.
Correct.
So,
and the rest of all the way up to operating from miscellaneous in reserve. We had a discussion about capital stabilization and where to put it. We have had a $1 carryover in the budget here. This is on the expense side, what's called the designated appropriations. And after going a meeting last Thursday with Sherry and with Brian, the accountant, we all left with homework, talked to the folks at DOR. We're going to keep this here, and we're going to ensure that our capital stabilization appropriation still is accounted in the way we have been doing it.
Did you see the $6,000 for the fields?
Hang on. Under town rec. No, I did not actually. I did, but I was jumping to something I knew about. Anybody from Rec here to talk about it?
In well, that was actually Community Pathways and preparing for their park grant. It was just for discussion purposes. The park grant that they're applying for won't pay for maintenance, and they need to show that we're willing to take on the maintenance of the field if they fund the grant. So that.
So they're going to pay for the lawnmower?
Yeah. Does this make it World Series quality?
It does.
No, I think they needed to show due diligence, I think.
Yeah, that the field would be maintained should right. the.
So if we give you the grant, you got to keep it up. But that doesn't address what your question is.
Well, my question is, you're going to have $6,000 in the budget. How is the $6,000 going to be spent?
Right. Good point.
Right?
I don't know that it was itemized.
It was.
Was it? Was it? Okay. I didn't see
I'll
that.
I'll pull that so you can see it.
A big chunk of it was mowing, right?
Yeah, mowing.
Didn't we have to take mowing out of our?
Right. If it's going to this, it's either augmenting and expanding an existing contract, or it needs to be moved from another expense under mowing.
So, Sherry, you get a little homework on that, okay, for next week?
Mm-hmm. Sure, it's an increase or whatever.
Wastewater.
Wastewater is
nice. Just so people know, mm-hmm. the wastewater plant was just in a. Was it a national publication for the good work that they're doing? So,
what publication was that?
What's that?
Do you know what publication it was?
WOP.
What's WOP?
That's a magazine that they were at.
Water.
That's water.
Water.
So
we have it downstairs.
We have it downstairs. As a matter of fact, I just the night after I saw it here, I had it in my office. So,
nice.
But it's a big thing in the wastewater world to be able to control your sludge and mm-hmm. your how much liquid sure. and percentage sure. and yeah. something that they haven't been able to control for years and years and years. Now they got it controlled.
Good for them.
It actually saves us money. Believe it or not, right. It actually saves us money when we ship it out for the sludge to be dewatered, because they're doing a much better job. Mm-hmm. They send out less trucks at less amount of money. So
to increase their solids.
It could get more solids, yeah. Yeah.
Control over the solids.
It's actually working out pretty well.
Nice.
We don't have any coal plants, so we don't have to worry about new influxes.
Exactly. But even though they're in WOP magazine, they're not nearly as cool as the Bolt.
That's right.
I remember asking even the mayor of Northampton one time, what was the most amazing thing that she learned in her job? She said, I never knew I was going to know so much about landfills. And that was Claire Higgins.
Claire, yeah.
And one of the interesting things when you're selecting, you learn a lot about BODs and
percent solids.
Percent.
The fact that you can incinerate liquid.
Yeah, where do you incinerate it? All right, debt, and debt and interest. We can talk about that in a second.
Yeah.
Anything else on the budget?
No, only to say that really the town's operating budget itself, as we go about tonight's exercise, is less about $10,000, $300,000-ish, and the numbers will be on the next week's version. And it still represents a 4% increase. Remember, bear in mind, waste treatment and then debt is off of, although we appropriate for it, they have separate funding sources.
Okay. You want to talk about the big sheet?
Yeah, I think it's important also to bear in mind, we've talked about this, and again, this is going to
Hold
change.
Hold on one second, Scott.
Yeah.
Mr. Our moderator?
On your other sheets, I may have missed it. What about that OPEB stuff that we used to be
receiving? Yep,
actually, that's coming up.
We actually still have an OPEB line item under benefits, and again, part of the free cash guidelines was to fund a piece of OPEB, a piece of capital stabilization or stabilization, and then the operating budget forward. And that's important to bear in mind. And what are we 28 in change this year, Sherry?
Yep.
$28 in this year. And there's some active discussion about OPEB philosophically, mechanically, if you will, although those two things are a bit disparate. You know, the notion that we're going to save up to our total liability in a given month, right, in a given period, is kind of set against the backdrop of the notion that not everybody leaves at the same time and it's not payable at one point. So the sustainability piece, you're actually in this position, actually, right? You're having your retiree, at some point, the fund has got to be able to support the number of retirees that are out there. Not that, I hope so too, not that it generates a total number of retirees on January 1st tomorrow.
Right.
So we're staying inside of our commitment to funding it. We have a liability that's kind of jaw-dropping. People go, what? Anyway, we're working to continue to fund that forward. And I think the accountant GASB folks and the DOR, that's accounting board, and then the DOR will work out where the kind of sweet spot is. But many communities around here, although being statutorily required to do it, and districts as well, are just getting started.
Thank you.
So it's in there. It's only 28,000.
All right.
Sorry.
So where are you going?
Oh, on the revenue side. There's nothing that's changed here with the revenue side. I think it's important to bear in mind, again, structurally, you have the sheet here that's highlighted. Finance Committee's got one. We actually have to put inside here the capital stabilization override so that we know where that money is going. We appropriate capital stabilization, and then from capital stabilization, we appropriate toward the capital budget, right? Those values were never shown here. It was always done through a warrant article. And now it was really important for us to show it in the revenue sheet. So it looks like there's revenue, and it's still going to be a town meeting article, but we weren't capturing it only on the, this is getting deep in the weeds, capturing it only on the recap sheet. And that's what the accountant brought forward in our discussion on Thursday. It's like, well, wait a minute. You guys appropriated. You're accounting for it for the state, but you didn't really, instead of warning the public, you didn't really show it in your revenue stream. This year, we're going to show it. And that revenue is generated explicitly on the rate, explicitly for capital override, capital stabilization, and it goes explicitly to the capital budget. It's just showing an in and an out. But structurally speaking, outside of the state, which has been in years past the bugaboo in the room, we still don't know what the state budget is, and right, we just don't know. And we have a theme. We kind of understand the general economic times, and we're going with the governor's submittal, and that's all we can do right now.
We're running a little behind.
Exactly, and we're running a little behind.
Yep.
So as it stands right now, this 105 would change and be somewhere in the $95,000 range based on the discussion tonight on the expense side. But this fluid, this number is, the deficit number is still dynamic.
All right, so just real quick, everybody sees where our tax levy, that's the raise and appropriate, that's the 2.5, that's all set.
Yeah.
Cap uses the capital override. The cherry sheet, these are estimated numbers right now from the governor's office, right?
The governor's number is 694. This is a little bit lower than that number, so there is some room there. We always go in conservatively.
Okay.
Last year's final number was 672,945. The governor's number is 694. We're at 658, so there's...
Just so you understand, that's how we got that number. Local receipts, that we're estimated to use next year, $555,000.
Right.
And we use the five-year averaging, 3 years averaging.
Right.
Okay. Comcast PEG access money, sewer reserve, Title V, CPA we haven't eroded yet, ambulance reserve. We're almost out of that, aren't we?
We are almost out of that.
Should be out, right.
Okay.
This would be the last year.
We'll have about $1,600 left.
Okay. Assessor's overlay, not planning on using anything this year. Free cash. Right now, we're looking at using 127,144 for free cash, right?
For the operating budget.
What's that?
For the operating budget.
Okay. Free cash to OPEB.
Mm-hmm.
$28,322.
That's going by the previously set policy, right?
Yes. That's by the finance committee's policy.
There's about $53,000 in there right now, so.
Okay.
Prior to this, Sherry?
Yeah.
Okay.
Then we're putting in what we have for state monies.
Right. These are the out of budget expenditures.
Yeah. This is all the stuff that we could assessments, we offsets. Yep. Right. These are the expense side.
So we are, I'm going to say 100,000.
Yeah, say 100,000.
So we're 100,000. Right here it says 105, 123. We did accept the personnel committee, so we're someplace in between 95 and 105,000.
Yep.
So right now we're looking at a deficit of about $100,000. So the question would be, are you looking at a 2.5 override this year, or are you looking at funding out of available funds? It would be free cash.
That would be free cash. It's important, again, it's important to bear in mind, speaking with the accountant, the free cash generation this time was a series of closures, and then recognizing that for a couple of years the capital stabilization override was moving in a different column.
Oh, right,
so,
absolutely.
Yeah. So 700,000 is something I think, as finance committee member, I think the first year as the finance committee back before the century began, it was the first year we had like $1 million. And that came up a series of one times. The accountant came in.
But we knew that was going to happen 18 months in advance.
Right, right. But it looked like
I remember telling the moderator that like a year and a half before it happened. And he had a full head of hair at that time.
Right. It looked like good times were going to roll. The reality is we want that free cash calculation
a one-time expenditure. Right. We knew. So what do you guys think?
You're recommending you take it out of free cash to balance the budget?
That would be the easiest method.
Yeah, next year we're still
going to be. It just puts off the inevitable.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, two things happen. One is you take care of the budget this year, and it also gives people 1 year to sell the override next year.
It's robbing Peter to pay Paul.
I understand. Trust me, I understand. I would agree with you that overrides have to start, unfortunately, in the schools because they get that's where the most conversation takes place. There's a lot of conversation that takes place in the schools, you know, with people. Our hardest part is getting penetration into the residents. I mean, a lot of residents, they have no idea, and schools do. Schools. So you'd have a year to sell. You'd have a year to sell the override.
Were we gonna discuss the debt? Is that coming later?
Mm-hmm. The debt category?
The debt and interest, yeah.
Sure.
Just the interest jumps. Was our interest rate on our sewer relining loan and our energy PC, did the rates just like jump?
No longer a refunding, I believe that's what happened with that.
Not a refunded debt?
Yeah, it's permanent.
That's a question we'll have get answer for you.
But I'll double check that with the treasurer, but I believe that's the.
How about that slight increase there on the number?
One thing I will say, and this is for someone who's looked at these categories for some time, it is so nice to see, and Bruce, you'll remember, there was a bunch of these that were specifically three that were on here for a couple of years that had zeros, and after our meeting on Thursday, I asked for the whole category to be removed. And it's a little bit bittersweet, but...
What's that on debt?
Yeah, but I think the board and the finance committee and the electorate made a strong commitment to reconstruction of the elementary school. And this is the first budget cycle since that unfortunate incident that there is no elementary school reconstruction principal and interest on this schedule. And, you know, a lot of people will miss it completely. And Thursday when we had our discussion, I'm like, okay, it's been a couple of years of zeros. Let's take it off. So, thank you, town. To answer your question, we will follow up with respect to, is it points? These are bands. What happened? Is it multiple years? What's the change? Specifically, sewer relining and then energy.
Okay. Any more questions on that? All right. So that $100,000 again.
Well, if you're going to have the discussion about use of free cash, Mr. Chair, I think it's important to bear in mind that the second page in the revenue sheet, balance and use of various accounts, includes free cash. And if we're going to use an additional $100,000 of free cash, that only leaves moving forward $91,000 going into a future year. Mm-hmm. And that's considerably less than we've used in the past. We try to be in the 150 range. And again, the formula is based on percentage. So you're starting free cash with $757,146. You got some unpaid bills, $5,000. You've got FY17 operating budget already at $127,000 based on the guidelines. If we add $100,000, you're talking about $227,000, round numbers. OPEB 28, stabilization 75, a couple of special town meeting. We have to reimburse. We have to reimburse the town for appropriation from special town meeting 2016, then capital stabilization. That's it. There's plugged in here $50,000 for the anniversary celebration fund. That's a discussion coming up, leaving $191,000. If we add another, say, 90-ish, we're in the $100,000 range, and that's it for free cash, right, short of moving it to reserves.
Right, but I heard we were flush with money.
I understand.
Along the way,
it's called paying for your budget. But it also goes back to the discussion about the override. I appreciate what you're saying about 18 months, 16 months to, you know, lay the groundwork for a discussion. I would be remiss for not pointing out that if it grows as expected and we begin talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars, it's a considerably more difficult sell than 150, 200 bucks.
Yeah, along those lines, and the other side of the year and a half, yeah, is that this is going to be another year and a half where people think they're getting away without the 2.5.
Sure, sentiment, right?
And we're just not going to get around within the next decade or so of a demographic shift where right now we're spending 60% of this budget goes to 366 kids who are not paying taxes. They're represented by, you know, fewer than that households, mm-hmm, assuming multiple kids per household. So, I mean, I don't think an additional year is going to sway people who can't be swayed right now. And that math just isn't going to change. I mean, that's 10% of our population. That's using 60% of our funding. And we can't, you know, something like the library where everybody's free to use that resource. That's for everybody. And even beyond, town beyond that. You know, that's a resource that we're going to then have to cut to spend more money on the kids. And it's, I think it's going to get harder and harder to get away from that 2.5. Not easier.
You know, I've stated my position is we're robbing Peter to pay Paul. Now, whether you think we're flush or not, Tom, we have free cash available. But the other money to do the operating budget, we need an override. And if you delay it, it's going to be a lot more. And it's up to us, the school committee, everybody else, to sell this to the rest of the people. And that's where it's important. And speaking from experience, it can be done.
So how do you explain to the town that you're gonna recommend we got a request for $125,000 for a celebration?
Yeah.
And at the same time, you're gonna ask them for an override.
Yeah, because a celebration is one thing that happens every 50 years. whereas the override and the tax rate to operate the town is something that happens every single year, Tom. And it's if we let it go another year, next year it's probably going to be 250 because we're not funding it from this year, you know. And to me, it's just not responsible to not at least put the override out there.
Celebration.
We haven't voted on it. We put in $100,000.
$125,000.
That's not from us. That's from the celebration committee. Yeah.
Celebration committee. Yeah.
Okay.
That's the selectmen's committee, by the way. They appointed us. We work for them.
Your override.
Sorry.
You're talking $100,000 override.
No, I think we have to determine the math. Yeah. If
roughly.
That's the deficit.
I think that's the operating budget deficit this currently as it stands right now. If we look at the use of some one-time revenues and know, as we said last week, know that in the last 2 years, the elementary school's cost have gone up $407,000-ish 2 years. It can be argued, you could weigh that out in half and ask for $250,000. If we know the increase that we're talking about in this operating budget, even at less than 1.9% across the whole budget, is going to come next year again, that could be another $100,000 worth. So you could be talking in the magnitude of 300 and change, really 300 and change, to allow us to raise that to be anticipation of next year's budget.
Right, I was going to say, for doing an override for $100,000 doesn't seem like it's worth the trouble.
Well, that's it. You're not really you're just covering this number, and that's really not an accurate look forward.
So back to your point, the question becomes really about kind of orders of magnitude. We did this once in 2009. It was like, sorry, that's the real number. This is what we have to go for. Put the real number out, it failed, and we had to cut that real number out. Totally understand that. This right now, the budget that we have in front of us has a structural deficit of $100,000, leaving $150,000 moving forward in free cash. If we look at the expense growth in this budget, operating budget in total, and I have three right here in front of me, if we look at this operating expense budget, it has a $300,000 growth this year, just this year, substantially driven, the majority of it driven by the elementary school. I totally understand that. We only raised 138 this year. So this carries forward to next year, minus the 100,000. You're starting in the $250,000 range to really do a reset, as Bruce has described. We've got to do this every now and then, right? In theory, that's one way of approaching it. So we're talking $250,000 of available levy capacity. Now that backfills part of this budget if it passes. If it doesn't passes, Tom's point is we can get through this year, and then next year this moves, plus whatever growth happens next year.
And then we're looking at cuts.
Because, I mean, the other piece of that is you know, a lot of what's driving the elementary school growth has been, you know, increase of, you know, 15% 1 year, 11.5% next year in the resident K-6 population.
Pre-K.
Huh? No? Okay. Well, K through 6 is 13 and 11. So it's close to the same. That moves on to, my point being, we're the one town in our district, mm-hmm, that with the student population's growing.
Yep.
The other ones, it's shrinking. So our percentage in Frontier is likely to continue to go up. So, you know, I don't know the magnitude of those numbers,
sure,
honestly, but they're going up, not down. So that's another driver going forward where that operating budget, that's going
to
go up.
We're about 27%+ contribution to the Frontiers budget.
And if you have a 6 years of increasing numbers that are just shifting from
element. That are shifting element, and it's been, exactly, it's been happening over several years. Going back to like FY14 or so. And the other thing I'd kick in is just not speaking for the school committee, but as a member being on the school committee and going through and having to go through cuts, if I would rather have a year to be figuring that out than 3 months or a month or whatever.
So are you saying, Doug, it would make sense to get through this year and work toward an override next year?
No, the opposite. I mean, I'd want to know. I mean, if it can't pass, then I'd rather know. But we can get through this year, but we know we can't do that again next year. Mm-hmm. I'd rather know this year and be trying to figure that out throughout the year, rather than have a couple weeks in between the override failing and what we got to deal with it.
So what happens next year when you come in with a 10% increase next year?
That's why I keep bringing this up in these meetings every time about the situation with choice in our budget, is that and if the population grew again that much again, I mean, we'd have to face that fact.
You only went up 3 kids this year. You went from 200 to 203, and you had a 6-point-something% increase.
We went from K through 6 resident 168 to K through 6 resident 186.
I'm looking at the total number in the school.
Total number in the school went from 233 to 258.
All right. Then what was the 200 on the budget that we were given? And I have it someplace which showed 200, and then it increased to 203 this year.
I don't know what you're looking at. I can give you.
I got a copy.
Every year, every version of it, but.
So 14 this year, Doug?
Huh?
14 this year?
It went up by 8. K through 6.
Yeah.
And again, I'm doing resident. I could do the total. The resident went up by 18.
Yep.
Total went up by 21.
Okay.
But I'd rather do the resident because I think the total is because we're just filling in and getting as much choice money we can without adding another teacher.
Right.
But so there's just the resident went up by 18. From FY16 to FY17.
Hmm.
The year before that, it went up 19. 2 years before that, it went up 14.
Hmm.
I think he's looking at the projected 18 number.
Maybe. It's 203.
260.
Oh.
Yeah,
257. The whole school. Right, so then so the total school went, goes maybe. So I think next year, I don't think we're forecasting the kind of jumps we've had the last 2 years.
Okay.
We had a big jump in FY14, 14 additional kids. Then it was stable for a year. And then we've had 2 more years of pretty big jumps. But we know so far, of the kindergarten, what we're looking at coming into the kindergarten is that it's not a
When I look at class sizes, right?
Yep.
I look at 32, in pre-K, 32. That's 16 in a class. So we're not going to add, you could add 10 students, and you're not adding an instructor.
In pre-K or
pre-K
or kindergarten?
It says PK. I approved that soon. That means pre-K.
Yeah.
It's on your budget, page 6 of 28. It says projected students is 32.
Mm-hmm.
All right. That means that means that you're probably having 2 classrooms for that grade level, and that's 16 kids in a class. So you're not going to add a teacher. You could grow by 10 kids total.
No, you
can't. Not in preschool.
No, you can't. The ratio is lower.
Yeah.
There's regulations on that.
Well, those kids are going to be in kindergarten next year.
No, but what I think the school is saying is that the mandated or the preferred ratios student to teacher are much lower than your normal classroom.
Right, but I'm saying those.
You can't add 10 kids.
Otherwise, we're going to put you in there.
Those 32 are going to go to kindergarten next year.
Yeah.
Well, not all of them. Some are three-year-olds and some are four-year-olds.
Right.
Right, because some are just going to the second year, right?
Right.
Okay, so that means you there may be that class grade will be shrinking. But the 35 presently in kindergarten mm-hmm. will go to grade one. That means so you have 18 and 7. Mm-hmm. You're not going to add a teacher there.
Right.
36 in grade one will be going to grade two. Mm-hmm. 36, that's 18 in a class. You're not adding a teacher
right.
there.
Right.
The next one is grade two is 37. Two teachers there, so you're not adding there. Grade three, you only have 22 kids. You may have to add a teacher there. Grade four is 40, will be going to fifth grade, there's 41 kids. Probably not adding a teacher there. Grade five is going to grade six, and there's 26 kids. You may add a teacher there, but there's a tough call.
Yeah, exactly.
So it'd be, I guess when I look at the thing, it's tough to add more teachers next year.
We're not anticipating that barring another influx in kindergarten, which we've had before. That would be the case. All of a sudden, we have a big influx. And it's happened in other grades, like, you know, partway through the cycle. I mean, our town is much less stable through the cycle. Like a lot of towns, you know, once you got your number in kindergarten, you know, plus or minus a couple, it's going to be that way through. And in Sunderland, you know, those numbers will move five or six sometimes in a year in a grade or, you know,
right.
seven. You know, so it's right. Our jumps, it's harder to predict. But in terms of what we're expecting for next year, we're not expecting to add another teacher.
Would it be helpful to review from a process standpoint what we'd have to do rather than dropping that into the numbers? In other words, if we do an override this year, if we don't do an override,
need to know tonight. If you want to do an override, you need to know tonight.
It has to be tonight.
Right. And, well, that's what I'm saying. So we should review, like, what, you know, if we put it in or if we don't put it in, what's going to happen? Because then we don't put it in, then we have to then essentially make cuts next year.
There's two approaches
or
that.
Or do another override.
There's two approaches that legal counsel has said we should take if we choose the path to include an override, and that has to do with the mechanics and the execution. One is, remember, this is an override that is going to stretch, it's going to expand our capacity to raise. So it's expanding our levy limit. The budget becomes predicated on the inclusion of this as the budget, including is predicated on the inclusion of the language supporting an override. If that fails, we go back and revisit the budget. We have a second path, that is you vote the budget, funding sources, and you vote to authorize an expansion of the levy limit through an override. The override fails, the budget in front of us has to be funded through raise and appropriate and free cash and all that stuff we'd normally do in a warrant article, right? Pretty standard budget language. And if a second article is used and the override election is held and the override passes, then the override values can be the inside the appropriation, the language raise and appropriate is captured in the original warrant article. Second article says authorized to raise blah, 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 blah through Proposition 2.5 override. The first pass by doing it with a single approach has us revisiting the budget at a subsequent town meeting to identify funding sources, right? You got to be able to have a funding source. If you do it with a two-article approach, you get through this year. If it fails, you've still funded the budget because we have that ability. We don't have to revisit it. I'm hesitant to use the second language approach, second question approach, only in that it's easy to pass off.
Right, and then we're left with the problem next year.
Holding it back.
We just push it off a year.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Either or. Yep. Given a shiny object, America has demonstrated that we'll follow the shiniest, numbest minded one out in the world. So those are the two mechanical pieces. And that's guidance from council with language to support it. And again, order of magnitude, if you're going to include a piece, I would suggest, Mr. Chair, if we're actually going to entertain the discussion and jump into that forum, that we should be starting in the $150,000 to $250,000 range for raise and appropriate. And that is less than the average growth of the last 2 years, the elementary school. That is less than the average 10-year growth of the annual operating budget. But it gives us something to go forward to. If I was going to do this as a dark sky exercise, the real number, it's in that 380 range. You guys look at the numbers, you know.
Just at least keeps us from being hamstrung.
Correct. Now again, to Tom's point, the chairman's point, the reality is you can't just spring it on. It took us a long time to build up consensus around a simple capital stabilization supplemental appropriation. That took a decade. And even that number was a compromise number, which we're benefiting from, but still a compromise number.
And we slipped that by one.
They're all out of town.
I heard we slipped that by one.
I heard that one too. Same thing. Like, when did you guys pass CPA? What are you talking about?
I will say to Bruce's point earlier that I think, I don't have a crystal ball, but times are a little different than when the previous recent overrides failed, which might mean that people would be better prepared to vote for it at this time, or not at least not vote against it, possibly. I'm sure we've got plenty of people in the town who are going to vote for it no matter what, and plenty of people in town are going to vote against it whether or not. And so then it's just. But last time I think it was economically, and there was a lot that drove people.
What's it actually going to? What's our tax rate now?
It's about
1360 something.
1360. So we had a $250,000 override. What?
Is it 14?
Yeah, I had the assessor calculate on a 150 override and a 200. So the 150 would raise the tax rate using this year's numbers by 43 cents. So the new tax rate would be 1477. And the second option, the additional 200,000, would bring the tax rate to 1492, an increase of 58 cents.
1492? Do you have what the average tax rate is in Franklin County,
Sherry? So on a home valued at $200,000 at the $150,000 level, it would raise the tax by $86. And at the $200,000 level, it would raise the taxes by $116.
A $400,000 house would be double that.
Yeah.
But a $400,000 house would be $232.
I could tell you like the median home price. Let's say here's what the change.
$250,300.
It's
like. So you're looking at.
$272.
Yeah.
$86. $100.
I think that's affordable.
I say if you do $200,000, you're going to have the same problem next year.
I think $200,000 is a realistic figure, and it will catch us up to that, Tom. I mean, if you want to go for a pie in the sky, you guys vote it.
If you do $200,000, you're in the education, the last two years has come in over the $200,000
right.
Alone. That's with nothing else, Bruce.
Tom, I realize that.
So you're going to do a 2.5 override every year?
But you take charter schools, what we're paying for that, we have no control over that. You take the increase in the benefits and stuff like that, we have no control over that.
But I think
that's what to me is so frustrating. And I think it's frustrating to a lot of other people. And from my point of view, what are we going to do? Just keep cutting the schools, cutting everything else? I don't think that's...
Well, this thing, all this does too is this lets us tread water. Like, we've never been able to actually really increase anything.
Right.
You know, I mean, this doesn't even let us increase programs or improve stuff.
Right, right. But at least we're treading water. We're staying there. We are going backwards.
Well, we take a suggestion from the finance committee. Put a number out there.
You said 383 was what you were proposing?
If you were to take the last 2 years of the elementary school, even if you simply took the this year and you wanted to fund this year's operating budget increase, that would be 311. Minus tonight's discussion, it'd be $300,000. Again, that's simply that's the line above waste treatment and above debt and interest. Again, with tonight's discussion, with if the library has on the table, 311 minus 10,000, $300,000.
I'm a big fan of facing a problem head on.
Well, listen, it's kind of irresponsible to not go for what we need. If we're
you need to go for at least what you need. Mm-hmm. At least. In my opinion, I mean, and if it's $311,000, then
that's what it is.
That's what it is. It is what it is.
Because then, we're back here doing the same thing again in like a year or two.
I think going to the electorate and saying I need $200,000, or going to the electorate and saying I need $300,000. You're still going to the electorate and asking for a substantial sum of money.
Absolutely.
So ask what you want. Be forthright with the electorate and say what you need. Mm-hmm. Period.
Just because, I mean, this, I don't know why this argument doesn't go further. I mean, just because that levy limit is increased doesn't mean that a budget to spend all of that doesn't have to be passed at a town meeting.
Right. Sure.
That, anybody can show up to and say, you know, I think that's extravagant and that needs to be taken out at any time.
Or,
I mean, we're not going to come.
How does it? And again, and I have to argue devil's advocate right now.
Sure.
Last year you had 10.6% increase. This year 6.6% increase. I mean, you know, education has been driving it. I'm not going to go up in front of people and recommend that you cut education. I've seen what it does. So if you're not going to then why I don't want to agree with you. If you're going to say you want an override of $100,000, in my opinion, you're not addressing the problem. Mm-hmm. If you say you want $200,000. That's fine. It's a nice gesture, but you know what? You're still not addressing the problem. We just last when you look at just last year, you had a 311, right? 311,000.
Yep.
And our ability to pay was $140,000.
Right.
Total.
So it's possible we could have that resident growth continue the way it's been, but some of the drivers, as we know, is we had a period where we had a lot of choice out after the budget was hit hard, and that stayed and it went through, and they've all graduated out of the elementary school, that class, and the classes behind, we didn't have that pattern, and so plus some actual growth of that age kids in the town,
but it was both,
so we don't have that other dynamic unless we slash our budget and we might be right back and seeing that again, but hopefully that's not the case, and so I don't know. I mean, if the population, you know, elementary age population continued to grow dramatically, then we would be coming back and saying our expenses have gone up because we've had at some point we'd be saying we need a bigger school because we can't fit in here anymore, but or you know something, but.
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, there's a discussion we've had
should go to the 311
select board level throughout the county too of wanting to increase population
311
because of our population decrease. That's kind of interesting in that way too.
I think if it was,
Alex.
Just back to the tracing out discussion. I mean, at some point, we save money by tracing out.
Yeah.
Right? It's cheaper if, than anything else.
If we did the whole school. I mean, if we didn't have a school, but we have to.
But, I mean, because we're required legally to have a minimum education if someone wants it.
Right.
So.
But yeah, if we just were paying $5,000, I mean, that's obviously way below what we spend per pupil. I mean, there's needs based on needs. There's going to be adjustments and things like that. You pay more for that if the kids, you know, has additional needs. But
can we save by going down to one classroom? Like, I mean,
the only
we're not
the only time
policy to like
the only,
make your school so terrible that people leave. But
so even the only time where our policy has been in recent years is the only time we're going for choice in a grade is where the resident population already puts us into a two classroom situation. Then we'll open it up and bring in some money because then the marginal revenue is exceeding the marginal cost at that point. Not that there isn't some marginal cost, there certainly is, but at that point the marginal revenue is exceeding it. You know, there is risk there that later on down the road you have a bunch of kids leave that grade, and really you could have done it in one classroom. So we're always kind of trying to look at, are we solidly over two classrooms, like, and do we really want to go into, you know, and in recent years we've been in that case where we are in certain grades. So it's like, and you know, if you look at the numbers, I think we've done some combination of luck and thought going into it. We've hit it pretty well with in terms of classroom sizes that we have, and the additional money we can bring in.
Well, I mean, when we're looking at these like 10% increases year over year, I mean, how much of a difference does a single classroom make? Is that where this increase is coming from? Is it for the students, or is it all extra?
Well, last year's was part of, a big chunk of last year's, though, was that formula adjustment, right? That the state said, oh, you've got to pay.
Yeah, right. But honestly, that was also our budget before. Whether they said that or not, I mean, that was kind of sort of closes the debate down pretty quickly, I guess, because we had to. But the truth was we had to. We had, like I said, I mean, the growth in the student population
increased.
You know, it was 25% over 2 years. And 2 years before that, it had been another 10%. So in a classroom, I mean, I'd back of the envelope, you know, $100,000.
$120.
So you know, percentage wise in our budget, that's a lot.
Well, you might be at the cusp of a demographic shift too, I think, in terms of you have an aging population that is starting to age out and retire and move out, and if you've got aging people, and this is something that I'd love to see some like data on. So you've got people aging, moving out, selling their homes. Odds are you're going to have people with kids on your soldier.
Well, it depends the price point of those homes, too, because like my generation can't really afford to buy those right now.
Right, but you know what I mean? Like, it's because the homes aren't selling, you know.
Yes, they are.
But it's all, quickly. You know, middle-aged folks with kids out of the home, right?
No inventory.
You're never going to see that home again. It's crazy.
But like, so on that population thing, like, to give you an example of the impact of the choice on helping drive our numbers up, you know, it was 24 in FY10, and I think actually at some point in the year it was higher, it was like 30, but Principal Merritt did a great job of convincing some families and getting some kids back in, but we had six, I think we're at six right now. So that's been part of it, is that families have come back. And yeah, to your point, it was in some ways, so in some sense, if we could do the whole school that way, yeah, it's cheaper to pay $5,000 a kid. But when we already have to have the classroom going, then it isn't. Then it's just another $5,000 whack on top of it.
Yeah, I had asked a question when Ben was here about the Horizons program. And I know you said it was cash positive.
It's a tuition program.
But it's labor intensive.
It is. Right now we have some students tuitioned in from Deerfield, but I also heard today we're looking at one from Hadley to join, and that is also revenue, but that money goes into the Special Education Revolving
Right.
Fund, and it pays for we have a teacher that runs the program, and that's where you're going to see the largest concentration of IAs, because the students
They're almost one-on-one. Are they almost one-on-one in there, or they are one?
Pretty much. And that's because the students require it. However, when they're tuitioned in, then we also can charge not only the tuition, but the cost of the IA.
Okay.
And the other side of that is if we tuition out, when we were doing this initially, I mean, the numbers were just like a I haven't looked at them in the very most recently, but it was just such a no-brainer because of what we were spending for tuitions out versus doing it.
The reason this is coming to us because it's more economical than sending them to another placement in East Hampton. That, you know, but we keep all our own in district, and that saves in Sunderland. So you're already. And
saving.
It's hard to say. You're saving $200,000 to $300,000 by keeping
right.
our own to say, you
and then
know,
you're and then your kids are tuitioning in.
Yeah.
Right.
So does
how many kids tuition in from out of Sunderland into Horizons?
I'm not exactly sure on the numbers, but I know that we have three tuitioned in.
Okay.
And there's probably five or six in the program now.
Got it.
But we may add another one. But they do a great job, but if we sent two or three out,
right.
Anywhere from $50,000, $70,000 to $100,000, that and we couldn't stop it. It's special ed. It's the law.
It's one of those things where, again, like not only the benefit of having the kids be able to stay in their town, which we want, but economically, it was also.
Yes, Michael.
Aren't we kind of getting off topic here?
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, we were.
Aren't we talking about an override and?
Going back to warrant and budget.
But I think it was point is because it was it's a expensive program within the school budget.
Right? It is, and that's so where the concentration and the pre-K. That's where those IAs are. Thank you.
All right.
Can I make one last comment, Tom?
Absolutely.
At least when we pay our local taxes, we know where the money goes. You know, when you pay your state tax, you pay your federal taxes, it goes into a big pit. No one knows where it ever goes. But at least our local taxes, we can see where it's going. We see it go to the elementary school. We see it go to the moderator's salary. We see it go every place, you know? And you know, at least you see it and you know what you get. And I think we get a good product for what we raise in the town. That's all I'm going to say.
Well said.
I think that's what we said 7, 8, 9 years ago.
Yeah,
didn't seem to work back then.
Nope, all you right. got to sell it.
Okay.
Isn't part of the issue just the fact that the people that attend town meeting and cast ballots are not the same people who are most strongly affected by this?
Correct.
The demographics of the people that are at town meeting
correct.
Are not people with kids.
Well,
but you gotta get the voters to ballot.
It's not town meeting.
Town meeting passes.
Yeah, it's not town meeting.
Those are people that, and typically those are the people that you're gonna sell it to. The people that go vote don't necessarily.
Not yet.
They're the ones that are hard. That's harder to penetrate that segment of our population with numbers. What you lose.
So I think, Tom, you were looking
for you guys for a recommendation.
For a recommendation. I think what we would recommend is the deficit on the fiscal year, which is $311,000.
Looking for an override of $100,000?
$311,000.
Okay.
It's important to bear in mind that the budget that's in front of us, operating deficits, just based on the recommendation from the bolt earlier, it would actually be almost $301,000, $10,000 reduction. So if I could enter for discussion, a nice round simple number like 300,
that works.
So is that a vote taken by the finance committee?
You want to talk about the warrant now, Scott?
Retail pricing. Right?
Well, we have to decide tonight, if I could, Mr. Chair, the order of magnitude of a potential override. And then secondly, we have to notify the town clerk in the morning if we're going to have a ballot question.
Right. So put a number out there.
I think $300,000.
Do I have a second?
A second.
Further discussion?
I think we've been down the discussion circuit. I struggle.
You want to give up on discussion?
Hey, I got talked down from 380 last week.
We've had a consensus agreement.
I have a motion made and seconded $300,000 all. Oh, well, on an override question, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No.
You wonder why it doesn't pass?
Sure.
Well, last time was for it, Mike, and it didn't pass. Okay? Now I know there's, and I think part of the selling process is that you have to have now is when you have to sell it, Michael, to tell you the truth. And now
our chair is not supporting it, so there's a good selling point. Our chair is not supporting it.
That'll make for good discussion.
That's your belief, Michael. Now over the next six weeks, can you convince me that's a good thing to do?
You're the chairman of the board. You are the chief executive officer of the community.
Thank you for reminding me.
Someone has to.
So if I could, Mr. Chair, the council has sent language that we should notify the clerk with. I think it's important the next discussion is to have around, do we want to include a single warrant article?
Single warrant.
Single warrant.
Yeah.
Budget would be voted contingent upon the passing.
Yeah. Motion.
I'll move to have a single warrant article included in the budget line, Article 4, including the warrant, including the override value of $300,000. To include on the warrant.
Huh?
To include on the warrant.
Okay. Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion?
Nope.
All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, Chair.
Okay, so Mr. Moderator, language for the warrant is going to shift, and we'll have a draft for you tomorrow afternoon. We have to notify the town clerk in the morning. Homework, if I could, Mr. Chair, leaving tonight is going to include plugging all the remaining numbers in this large spreadsheet.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I took my phone out only because I had the draft language. This is how selectmen get emailed, by the way, which is really annoying to a guy like me.
Did you get the wording?
It's the font is really small.
Yeah.
So you get
the wording.
Yeah. The wording is right here.
So you want a motion to include in the warrant?
Include in the warrant. And Sherry, it's
the ballot question. I need the vote of the board. Shall the town of Sunderland be allowed to additional $300,000?
That's it, right there.
Real estate and personal property taxes for the purpose of funding the operation.
Also, I move to include that language for a ballot question submission to the town clerk.
Second.
We have a motion made and seconded $300,000 to submit language to the clerk for a ballot question. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0, Chair.
Okay, so we have a ballot. We have inclusion on the warrant. We have a value. The operating budget number, again, is a piece of work in progress. We can't necessarily vote that tonight. As we don't have.
We have to redo the personnel numbers.
Correct.
And you have to get the new numbers from the school for the energy.
Correct.
Line item.
Yeah, that washes out. It's important to bear in mind if we look at, and I know I'm jumping a little bit, as we have another piece of business in front of us. We're in the current use of cash sheets. We have $191,000 moving forward, remaining in free cash to move forward to 2019. So now we have any more discussion on the warrant, you think?
Yeah, we got to go on the warrant because we have a late inclusion.
Got it.
So. Which one would that be?
We have these included. One, we should look at our minutes. We have one was included. Two was a hold because it was a money article. Three was a hold because it was a money article. Four was a hold.
Mm-hmm. Well, three we include. Three we include without recommendation.
Yeah, right. We move to include.
All right.
Yeah.
No recommendation.
No
right?
Recommendations. All exactly. Right.
Four.
Four is the budget.
Five.
Yeah. stabilization move. That's free cash guideline we already included.
All right, so motion.
Move to recommend.
Second. Motion made and seconded to include Article 5 for the our free cash formula.
Aye.
All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0. Six.
We need to pass over six right now.
We're going to pass over 6-7.
Capital Committee is meeting tomorrow night. Capital budget, same. Pass over until tomorrow night's recommendation.
Okay. Article 7 is a fire truck.
Article 8 is the one I have. It's important you're on the right one.
So.
You have another warrant?
I added the warrant article for the...
you have today's handout?
What's
down.
That?
You have today's handout? There is an additional warrant article. It's important we're on the right warrant.
Where's the numbers on them?
So if you're looking at 7, Article 7 is capital stabilization, the one I'm looking at. Fire truck is actually capital, is Article 8.
Right there.
Ding, 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 ding. So we're at actually 8, which is the fire truck.
Article 7?
7 is capital stabilization, and I would suggest we pass over until tomorrow night's CI, Capital Improvement Committee meeting.
Article 8 is
fire truck.
Fire truck. Article 9, CPA, we already got that in.
Yep, 3-0.
Article 10.
3-0 already.
Article 11.
3-0 already.
CPA, Article 12.
CPA moving forward.
Oh, this is how they
fund the upcoming
where it needs
year.
To go.
Yep.
Article 13, to see if the town will vote to raise an appropriate transfer from mail funds or otherwise provide the sum of
blank.
We have a petition and we have a request, an email, right?
We do, yeah, it's in your agenda materials.
Googly.
David?
All right. I'll do the letter here. This is dated March 28, 2017, to the Board of Selectmen. At our 300th anniversary committee meeting held February 2nd, 2017, a vote was taken to request funding from the town of Sunderland. We are requesting $125,000 to fund our planned historic 300th anniversary. We thank you for your consideration. Tom Zemnowski, Chair.
Okay. We also have a citizen's petition.
Yes. And this is the petition. I'll read it. It says, we, the undersigned registered voters of the town of Sunderland, do hereby petition the Board of Selectmen to insert the following article in the warrant for the 2017 annual town meeting. Article, to appropriate the sum of $100,000 from free cash to be used for the town of Sunderland 300th anniversary celebration to be held in the calendar year 2018. The money shall be divided as follows: $35,000 for the parade committee, $35,000 for the 300th anniversary committee, and $30,000 for general 300th anniversary celebration expenses.
And the clerk has certified this.
What's that?
The clerk has certified this.
Okay. So that petition was had arrived late, but we had already put an article whole place in. So what number are we using?
I'd go with the committees. The celebration committees, the first number.
25 one?
Yeah.
I concur.
Is that your understanding, Michael, also?
Yes. I couldn't make last month's meeting because of an employment issue, but I understand that was the figure that was voted on at the meeting in February or March.
So probably going to discuss more definitive budget the next meeting or two before town meeting. Come with a number. That
I don't want to speak for the chair. I don't know what the chair's got. We'll be meeting Thursday.
Okay. So we just have to take a vote if we want to include it on the warrant.
The citizen's petition or the recommendation?
Citizen's petition came in late.
Right, citizen's petition came in late. We have a bylaw for that.
Right. So I would say go with the 125 because that's what came from the...
From the committee.
That's what came from the committee.
Yep.
Okay.
Mr. Moderator? you have a question?
I was wondering about the petition, whether or not you had any options, whether you had to include it or not.
Because we have a bylaw that governs what's on the warrant, because you have 10 signatures, the 10 signatures says that it would be on the next appropriate town meeting or special, whatever occurs. So
the bylaw states 6 weeks.
Right.
The state statute says before the warrant closes.
Right.
We were unaware of the bylaw.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
the bylaw in like 99.
2004, I think it was. You must have snuck that through, Tom.
Actually, I did. That was one of the first things that we did because I was tired of listening to people tell us that we were always sneaking through warrant articles without telling anybody. So we changed the bylaws so that we actually had a bylaw to govern. So you are right, we did sneak
it out. I know, yeah.
But so people couldn't sneak it out. It was an anti-sneaking bylaw.
Snuck in.
All right, so I'm going to put 120. We're going to use 125 right now.
Fine.
I mean, Bruce, you were part of one of the members of the petition.
That was insurance, Tom. That was insurance.
I understand, but we had already put it on.
Yeah, we were unaware of that.
I understand. 125. I just want you guys to know that it was there. We're going to go with a 125 because that's what that's what the committee had recommended.
Chair said,
the chair wrote a letter. There can be further discussion. That can be amended up or down at town meeting.
Yes. Yes.
Right? Okay.
This is 125 as presented by the chair of the 300th committee.
This is Article 13 as it's presented.
Can we change numbers?
could it be number 30?
That's a good point, actually. Currently, it's listed as 30.
Is your trailer still available?
The what?
Is your trailer still available?
What trailer?
When did you guys use last time for the override?
No. I never used it. I wasn't part of the trailer, Bob. Tom knows more about the trailer than I do.
All right, so we have a motion made.
We won't be back in 50 years from now, Bob.
We have a motion made.
Motion has been made. I'll second the motion. This is to include Article 13 with a value of $125,000.
Any further discussion?
I would ask, as we go about the budgeting process here, the motion is going to be interesting to see where this funding comes from. If we use it exclusively for free cash.
The petition said free cash.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but
we're not using the petition.
The petition's null and void.
We're not using the petition. Again, we'll have to work closely with the Finance Committee as to see where this comes from.
Yes, we will.
Moving to no more discussion.
So yeah, motion made, second. Any more discussion? Finance Committee, you want to talk about that? But you're gonna have to make a recommendation anyways. So, all right, all those in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? 3-0. All right. What other ones we got there, Mr. Bertrand?
14. We've got a value for purpose of planning, upgrading, renovating. Are they going to remove this? Withdraw this?
There's a meeting Wednesday night for further discussion, so
hold on that. And the second with the next is Citizens United. Citizens petition. We already moved to include.
We already got that on. Article
16.
We already put that one on, right? That's a speed limit.
That is.
We're setting speed limits.
Correct. That's adopting 17. A statute. 17 is codifying the fact that Frontier can use money they already used.
They want to use the last 17,000. Okay.
Yeah.
18.
Actually, if I could, Mr. Chair, without the minutes here.
What's that?
Sherry, did we include 817 already? I think we did. Hang on.
Yeah, we did that last week.
Just want to make sure.
Yes, we did.
Yep. 17 through 24 already included, Mr. Chair. Oh.
18 through 24.
Well, now it's 17.
Yeah.
Well, that's a new 17, so it would be the new 18 through 24.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
Those are consent articles.
Correct. Okay.
That's it for
the warrant.
Pretty small warrant, really.
I think that, yeah, I think it'll be lively discussion.
pretty short one, though.
Yeah. No doubt about that.
All right, Mr. Moderator, we're going to go in with one question. We have to think about how we're going to have a second meeting.
All right.
You keep it. Oh, please, if it gets for extending.
If it fails.
All right, so that's it. My dad's stuff. You got anything else?
What's that?
You got anything else?
I don't.
So I think next week we finish off some stuff.
We should have a final number for the budget next week, including funding sources.
Yep, we'll have final numbers. And start selling the override.
We'll also have a capital budget for next week.
Okay, we'll talk about capital last. Minutes of
big motion to accept
police.
Motion made.
I'll second.
We have to talk about police.
So all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Sherry, any town administrator updates?
Nothing at this time.
Okay. Scott, you want to add anything?
Oh, Mr. Chair, I'd like
to
thank the people in the room for the discussion tonight.
The only thing I'd like to add is that.
Do you meet outside? Okay.
We will have a discussion over the next few weeks about the budget. It should happen. The discussion will be a good discussion. I hope we all do it in a. Understanding that it's important to have a discussion between be on different sides of the discussion. That's okay. And it's just as important to listen as it is to talk. We'll see what happens.
Exactly.
That's why I like serving with you two, as we do have our ability to communicate, and that's a good thing. Even when we don't disagree with one another.
Good point.
Yep.
All right. Anything else?
I want to read something, if I could, Mr. Chair.
I have five updates. Wait a minute.
No.
So our founding fathers, in particular, a handful were fans of Cicero, if anybody is interested. And Cicero wrote in De Finibus 1.63, "The wise man is little inconvenienced by fortune. Things that matter are under the control of his own judgment and reason."
I thought you were going to say the wise man isn't concerned with facts.
No, that was
that would not be.
Okay.
I think it's important to bear in mind Cicero was one of George Washington's favorites. Anyway, enough ancient Greece.
Yeah. All right. Anything else, Mr. Moderator? You going to say anything? You were saying stuff earlier, though, but under your breath. All those in favor? Oh, I need a motion.
Move to adjourn.
Motion. Oh, second.
And motion made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye.